Here we go, guys. So, just going to go ahead and put this out there for the audience. You guys are my ears tonight, guys. I was just being having a great conversation with the panel before the show, and they were saying, Mooch, you sound a little low. So I upped the ante on my microphone. The problem with this microphone and mixer is I could actually get extremely loud and uncomfortably loud. So if it is too loud, please do let me know, and I can change the settings as we go on the fly. So I apologize. I may have to get a new mixer. I'm not really sure what it is, actually. But I got to say, outstanding show we're going to have for you guys tonight. As you can see, we have an amazing panel. We have a few people joining us on the second hour as well. I do want to say this much. Please take a second, guys. Hit the like button. Hit the subscribe button. We're just about to cross the 12,000 mark here on the channel, which for me, again, I'm excited. For me, that's like 100,000. It's like 100K. Very excited about this. Everyone says, sounds good. Guys, let me know. Keep it up throughout the whole thing. If any of the panel members sound low, I can also adjust that on the fly. But if you will, look at that amazing description down below right there. Above that is the join button. If you'll consider becoming a Mooch Maniac family member, I would truly, truly appreciate it. But hitting that subscribe button means the world to me as well. And becoming a family member just by being here, being present, and checking out the videos and podcasts that we have on the channel. Really appreciate that. Let me just call each one of these individuals out one by one, because I do want to get to these amazing topics, and I only have some of these panel members for so long. The great JudaZuk, WoolleyGamer, MumbleRanting Gaming, sorry, he's almost mumbled, MumbleRanting Gaming, TysonWeb509, True Witty, Alfonso Carter, Brap, Damien, the great Jimmy Harrison, who's listening to the show, Andy Hart, RedHood420, HamSolo5, Rob Jones, NightRipper7, Toto Dope, Thumbs Thumbs, JC2013, Lord Metroid, Rabbit Got the Gun, Fastbender, Archware Angel, Biggity08, Slowmo Backslap. Shout out to Slowmo and Gaming Forte. We're going to be doing DPS 9 p.m. Eastern tonight, right after this show. Henry Heck, Silent Merc, who's here, Slaying Chilean, Ice Queen Gaming, Otacon Ocelot. I hope I'm saying it right. J Row 49, our Major Mooch Maniacs, E Kim, Bitrate, RPG88, Krishna Bad, Gamer, 4-Star General, Truth Serum, your boy Roy, Scolari Brothers, DC Gaming, Miko, J Bari, and Gaming with Persona. You guys know they go live 11 a.m. Eastern Time Saturday mornings on What's Up PlayStation. Shout out to them, guys. That's how I start my Saturdays. That's how I recommend you guys start yours. Tactical Gamer, Danelle Brown, That Guy Smitty, Brian B, aka Delirium Blades, and our VIP Mooch Maniacs, Raji, and Domino Zero. Guys, and our forever Mooch Maniacs, I cannot go without giving these guys shout-outs, the great Longshot 316 and the great Optimus Code. Guys, I'm very excited about tonight's show because a lot of news broke. A lot of things happened in the past 48 hours. And I know the panel that I have assembled can't wait to get to it. So I'll just introduce these guys one by one really quick. The great Basement Radio Arcade Podcast, Brap! Brap, how you doing tonight, buddy?
Hey, what's going on, Mooch? Panel, everyone listening to us live. Good evening. It's great to be here. It's going to be a great show tonight. Lots to talk about.
It's going to be fantastic. Shout out to the great Rob Jones. He says, Mooch, hope you're good. Another great show today. It's going to be a great show. That's for darn sure. Thank you so much, Rob. Listen, this is an honor to have him back here, and I only have him for so long. But the great Mr. Badbit. The great Mr. Badbit is back. And, you know, Badbit, you've had a lot to say on Twitter in the past, I'd say, 48 to 72 hours. I've been monitoring the great Mr. Badbit on Twitter. Have I? Yes, you're very opinionated. Come on, the Bloodborne talk, the Elden Ring talk. This is your world, Badbit.
And I want the credit where credit's due. I've been saying it for gosh dang years. That non-committal answer by Miyazaki, you know something's happening behind the
yes,
scenes.
Yes, it is.
I'm not it is. It is. And everybody that calls me delusional online, oh, who's going to have final laugh? Who's going to have the final laugh? Me.
You
when
are.
I see it, oh my God, it's going to be beautiful. It's going to be gorgeous. I'm happy to be here, though. I do have a lot to say. A lot has happened in 48 hours. It's been quite a week, guys. Like yesterday felt like a week worth of news in like 3 hours. So I'm ready to, I'm ready to celebrate some games with y'all.
Well, let's get into it. The great Eric Jackson's with us tonight, and you know, there's going to be a little nonsense. I'm sure there'll be a little nonsense of topics we're going to get into. So the voice of reason has joined us this week, which is an honor. Eric, welcome back to the show, buddy. How you doing tonight?
I'm doing great, man. I appreciate you having me. Great panel. Like you said, man, lots to talk about. I'm going to try to be your voice of reason, but I've been kind of, I don't know, man. I've been seeing some stuff that's just got me like,
well, I noticed,
come on,
you know,
come on, community. Don't allow this. Don't allow this stuff to happen, man.
You were calling people out left and right. And when you do that, Eric, I know that you're at the top. Your thermostat's at the top, is you're about to blow. So this is the place to actually let that opinion out. And let me tell you, E, you're going to have some help tonight. One of your fellow panel members is on the show with us tonight. The great B Money said he could make it, and I was very excited about this. B, you've been saying things that have been going on that would go on for years, B. It's finally starting to come to fruition. B, how you doing tonight?
Doing great, man. I appreciate you sending over the invite. I was glad I was able to make it. Pretty solid panel that you have here. Some great voices in the community. So let's get to it, man. A lot of stuff that I've been saying is happening, just like I said it would. So let's get to it.
Well, B, you could take all the credit you want on the show tonight. You've earned that. Speaking of great voices, listen, they say he sounds like me. How can I argue without that? How do you argue without that? The great Mag is back, or as I like to call my neighbor upstairs in Canada. Mag, yep. How the hell are you doing tonight, buddy?
I got to tell you, I'm excited to be here. I didn't do a show on Monday, so I got a lot to get out of my system. And I got to tell you, I am absolutely the last person you come to if you want the voice of reason. I'm going to be emotional. That's the way I am. But I don't get stupid. You know what the only difference is? I speak facts, and I speak things that people don't want to hear. I tell you what you don't want to hear because that's the truth. And that's the problem with people these days. And we're going to get into that tonight. And I'm going to put it out there and show everybody exactly what's been going on, what's going to happen, how it's going to go. And you're not going to like it. And not everybody's going to like exactly what's going to happen. But that's the way it's going to be. And that's what we're going to do. So let's get into the show. We got a lot to talk about. I'm already pissed off. Let's go, Mooch. Go.
You got it, Meg. But certainly, last but certainly not least, the great Jack Move Johnny's with us from Weapon Wheel Podcast, 5:30 p.m. Eastern Time, Sunday nights. You know, Jack, right now, what he doesn't realize is I've already given him undershare. He's got the matches and he's got the fuel tonight. He can literally light this show on fire himself. Jack, you've also been absolutely electric the past couple of weeks on Twitter with your opinions, especially on tonight's topics. Jack, how you doing this evening?
I'm doing good, man. Nice to be back. You know what I mean? Shout out to the panel. Shout out to the viewers. Let's get it.
All right, you got it. So you know what? Let's get into this first and foremost. So I'm going to go ahead and put Meg on the hot seat here. Meg, listen, you wrote me. You said, I got some things I got to get off my chest. And I know that what you're going to say is literally going to be a domino effect right down the rest of the panel. So let's just talk about let's just talk about it right off the top. The Xbox exclusives. Okay. They were saying a week ago when we saw the Xbox official podcast, what was going to happen. Four games, Mag. They said four games. Yeah. We now know them. Sea of Thieves, Hi-Fi Rush, Pentiment, Grounded, going to PlayStation 5, going to Switch in the very near future. But now we're hearing, listen, we heard this. The gates are open. The floodgate may be coming sooner than we thought. Here's the deal. They're saying now, Mag, that we may be getting even like the Crackdown trilogy. We may be getting this. We may be getting that. Meg, I want to hear what you think, because I didn't get a chance to talk to you too much last week. What did you think between the Xbox podcast you saw and what's transpired today and yesterday, especially with the Nintendo Direct news and that being official coming from Nintendo first? What's your take on all this? Because I know you're heated on multiple subjects.
Okay. Buckle up. I got a lot to talk about here, but I'll be as quick as I humanly possible. First and foremost, The apology tour 2024 that they did, that they seem to do every 2 years or 18 months, absolute joke. I watched that thing and I sat there and I'm like, I don't believe a single goddamn word that they're saying. And it was just, it just didn't come across as genuine to me. You could tell they're holding back. You could tell that they're upset. You could tell that they were upset that this came out. And the thing is, there's a reason why I didn't apologize to anybody on Twitter or YouTube and whatever. People coming up, everybody needs to apologize. And I'm like, for what? Because everything that we talked about absolutely happened. Every last game that we talked about happened. Now, the other thing is, some people were speculating about games like Starfield, Indy Jones, whatever else. Well, I'm not going to get into that. But if people's listening comprehension is actually a little bit better, they would understand that they actually said in consideration. Mm. Those were games that are in consideration. Those are things that those Xbox executives easily didn't even address. You know why? Because they don't have to. So what they did is, and I spoke to my person, and you know what he said to me right after that show? He goes, did you think they were going to make you look good and make themselves look bad? Or do you think they were going to make themselves look good and make you guys look bad? And that's exactly what happened. And they did that by not even addressing the fact that other games have been considered because they don't want to start an entire shitstorm. I get it. However, at the end of the day, when it all comes down to it, we knew that those four games were there. Actually, funny enough, I will stand by this. The one game that my person talked about, who's batting 1,000 out of 1,000, I'd like to add, since September, The only difference is he named those four games, and the only, you know what the fifth game it was? He never said Starfield, and he never said Indy Jones. He said the Gear. He said the Gears of War collection. So he said those four games and Gears of War collection. So I haven't said a word about that because I'm like, well, let's see what happens. Again, we're just reporting what other people are telling us. Anyways, I mean, I'm not going to get into that. The point is that once again, we have got to this point. If you guys remember 2016, you remember 2016, Phil had another apology tour about the games going to PC.
That's right.
And his wording, I went back and watched it because Reforged Gaming talked about it. And I'm like, you know what? I got to go back and watch this. So I went back and watched it. Jesus Christ, it was almost the same speech. Yep. It was almost word for word the same speech. And what did he say then? Well, not everything's going to go to PC. We're only going to do this and that, whatever. Ba-ba-ba-ba. 1 inch at a time. Yeah, okay, just the tip. All right, we're going to do that. And then, and then guess what ends up happening? The next thing you know, you go, oh, the whole thing's inside. And that's exactly what ended up happening. What do we got to this day?
Oh, my
PC
God.
Game. Hey, man, I'm sorry. That's just the only analogy I can think of. But you know what the thing is? What happens now? Every single game goes day and date on PC. And now you listen to this speech from last week, and it was like, well, not everything's going to go. And then he sounded like the, you know, like the Scarecrow in the Wizard of Oz. Well, the Emerald City's that way. And he's pointing in two different directions because he's saying, well, Starfield and Indy Jones are not the first four, but we won't rule it out later. And I'm like, okay, so basically you're saying nothing. You're saying that you're basically just leaving the door wide open. When they announced those games the other day, and this is the part that actually made me giggle a little bit. I'm saying, okay, so were they actually going to? The reason why they pushed this little soiree they had last week, the reason why they pushed it up is because we leaked it out, right? About the story and everything else. Myself and a number of other people did. And they moved it up. So my question is, was Nintendo going to announce this? Not Microsoft?
That's the question.
Yeah.
How embarrassing is that? Like, if you think about it, if Nintendo came out and say, oh, by the way, these games are all coming to and then everybody's going to turn slowly to Microsoft and go, yo, what were you not going to tell us? And then they're going to be like, oh, my bad. Yeah, those games are coming to,
I wouldn't have put it past them to do it exactly that way.
Right, exactly.
So I don't know why anybody would be surprised by that. And the fact that they pushed that direct back, because that's what we heard, is that they were going to do that, right? And they ended up pushing it back. So it was like, there it is right there. So,
right, and ahead, how man. Embarrassing is that? That's embarrassing to me. If I were a hardcore Xbox gamer, I would be embarrassed by that. I'd be like, wow, that's a position of weakness. That's not a position of power and control. And then, of course, what they did last week was a reaction to what ended up happening. But anyways, the other thing is I already mentioned the double speak, the Nintendo Direct. There's a couple other things I was going to say. The other thing I was going to say is that by doing all this, hey, they can do whatever they want. It's their business, not mine. They owe me nothing. They owe anybody nothing. But the reason why they keep pivoting over, Mooch, you've been talking about this for 9 years,
yeah,
and I've been listening to you and doing shows with you over these years, and what have they been doing every 2 years? All right, well, the vision is this, the vision is that, the vision is this, the vision is that. They keep pivoting, and they have to pivot, and you mentioned that actually in the pre-show. They have to pivot. You know, the thing is, people look at Sony and Nintendo going, ah, they're always behind. They're not behind.
No,
they're so far ahead. They don't need to pivot their business model. No matter what anybody says or other narratives, whatever, they don't have to. Mm-hmm. And so that's why Microsoft keeps going off-road in this direction, that direction. But the problem is, along the way, not only have you lost engagement of customers, you are losing your identity. And as a result of losing your identity, you are losing even more customers. The momentum is dying. The problem is these games, the reason why they're doing this is because they're not being engaged. They're not trying to get extra money from PlayStation and Nintendo. They're not. They're trying to just recoup money that they're not getting on their own consoles because they're not getting the engagement.
Bingo.
Half of these games are coming out, are dead on arrival. Even Halo, for Christ's sake. People are telling me now, oh, Halo's great now. I'm like 2 years after everybody stopped playing it. You know what I mean? Forza Motorsport came out at 9 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. By 9:14, it was dead.
That's my point right there is what you're saying.
Oh, not, my God.
No, he's not sake, wrong.
I'm tired of it.
He's not wrong. He's not wrong. And that was one of the discussions.
Am I wrong?
No, you're not wrong. You're not
talking
wrong.
About it?
You're not wrong. That's the thing. So when it comes down to it, and it's one of the discussion pieces I had, Mac, thanks for saying that. I was going to bring the discussion up later, but the
that's
real problem.
That's a tough act to follow, by the way, Mooch.
But the real problem isn't really that Xbox going third party. It is the quality of their games. And every time I bring up the quality of their games, Mag, you know what people hit me with? Well, yeah, Halo got an 87 Metacritic. That doesn't mean
anything.
No one's playing it.
Stuffy. No one's played it. And you know, the thing is, last thing I'm going to say, and I'll pass it off. You guys have a field day. The thing is that if you do not have, and I said this with Colt, I said this everywhere else on all these other shows, and mostly to the, you know, more mortified faces, is that it doesn't matter about how many visions you have. It doesn't matter how many apology tours. It doesn't matter how many doublespeak corporal bullshit lines you give us. If you do not have compelling software, then nobody cares. Nobody's going to play your games. If you do not have games that when you go to bed, you're thinking about it, when you're at work going, how am I going to get into that cave? Or whatever. You know what I mean? You think about it. You talk about it with your friends.
Is that a tip reference?
Yeah, right. You know what I'm saying? But the thing is, if you don't have compelling software that people are talking about, it's not in the zeitgeist of conversation with casuals and hardcore, you are not going to go anywhere. So they can vision all they want, but if you do not deliver the goods, and like I said, people said 2023 was a great year. No, it wasn't. I'll break it down for you in 45 seconds. Hi-Fi Rush was great. It was great. Have you looked at the achievements? Have you looked at the achievement completions?
Oh, yeah.
It's like only 30% completed level 2. It wasn't a stupid achievement like, you know, shoot 40 enemies while on your head, you know, whatever, balancing plates. It was literally just finish level 2. It was 30%. That means that some people played it. Most people didn't even bother playing after 10 minutes.
Right.
You go into Redfall. Absolute travesty. I think that and Gollum might be the games of the generation for worst games ever. Starfield, I'm going to call it mediocre. You know why? You know what the definition of mediocre means? It means half liked it, half didn't like it. Because that's exactly what it ended up being. So therefore, my definition, I
thought that was a generational game, eh?
Yeah, right. Generational, my ass. It is a mediocre game. And then, I said 5 minutes ago, Forza Motorsport, dead on arrival. Those are your four games last year. They had a great showcase in January, and then they dropped this turd right after that, and whatever, and you know, I don't know how many rakes these guys keep stepping on, but you know what? It's embarrassing at this
point.
Wonder
they're
losing
why.
Their identity, and they're losing their
can I chime in real quick?
Go ahead.
I want to go back to something Mag said, and Mag, I'm glad you brought up, I think you said 2015 or 2016, when they talked about going to PC, and I'm reading something from 2016. This is June 15, 2016. And I'm reading this and I'm like, holy shit. Like, this has been the same messaging for the last decade now. Phil Spencer, Microsoft is learning to ship PC games again. That word learning, which he used at the Xbox showcase. He also says, we got to earn it. He also talks about bringing more games to creators and this is back in 2015, putting games everywhere where gamers can touch more content and stuff. I mean, these are the same word tracks that he used last week, 10 years ago. It's crazy.
The only reason why I watched it, and yes, I'm a rounded gamer. I play everything. I watch everything.
Yeah.
I don't care. I watch PlayStation podcasts, Xbox podcasts. I watch whatever. And I was watching Reforged, and he was speaking a lot of sense. I know some people shit all over this guy. The guy is speaking a lot of sense, and I'm listening to him going, huh. So I went back, and I watched that 2016 interview, and I'm going, Jesus Christ, it's almost the same script. I'm like, yeah,
it really is.
It is ridiculous. So, how do people keep buying this?
Thing is, like, in as like a PlayStation gamer, so like, you know, I'm not part of the Xbox community zeitgeist, so just as an outsider looking in, the thing that annoys me is, you know, when and how Xbox decides to communicate. Like, I said this on the Trophy Room this week. It's like Xbox's problem is the exact opposite of PlayStation's problem, where we want PlayStation to talk to us more, right? We want to know more about what's, you know, over the horizon. With Xbox, it's like, y'all need to just shut up. y'all, you're right, Mag. The whole podcast
is a holdover.
Was a nothing burger. It told
it
us
nothing.
In what we coined is like it's a you know, when you say something without saying it, I called it a Spencerism last night, which is like you said what you needed to say without explicitly saying that these four games are the test bed. Like they're going to see if these games hit, and then they'll continue. These are the low risk, low reward to see if PlayStation gamers and Nintendo gamers are going to go out there and buy Pentiment, going to go out there and buy.
Hey, bit, what if Phil say bit?
It's going to be a death by a thousand cuts. Look, we're talking about.
I don't believe this. I don't believe this. You know what they're going to say? They're going to say, well, Pentiment didn't do great, but you know what will do great? Gears of War.
Yep.
And then they're going to start doing that. They're going to say, well, we sold, whatever, 1,000 copies of this. That obviously isn't big, but you know what is big? If Halo went over there or whatever, because they're going to look at it that way. Never played Halo on weed. The CFO, yeah, right. The CFO, Satya Nadella, has literally word for word told everybody exactly what his plan was. And then people act shocked when he does it. It's like me telling you I'm going to slap you in the face. And then I slap you in the face and you act shocked that I did it. It's like he's literally spelling it out. The CFO spelling it out. Now, the other thing is, one last thing, bad bit, you said, you know, they're going to use this as a test ground. They're full of shit. And you know why they're full of shit? I'll tell you why. Is because they already have these things in production. And the reason is because it doesn't happen overnight.
That's right.
And they're already working on those other games. You listen, I had a nice long discussion with Tom Warren from The Verge. And we were talking about it. I'm not going to get into what we talked about because it's private. But I can tell you one thing. These things do not happen overnight. They're already in the works and working on it as we speak.
No, the fact Hi-Fi Rush is dropping next month tells you.
They don't need the test bed anyway.
Exactly. So my original point is they're going to use these games as going, okay, let's see what happens if we put, again, we crack down on multiple platforms. They're going to give you the death by a thousand cuts where it's like, this is not Halo yet. This is not, you know, I don't know, Forza yet, whatever the next big game is yet. These are the little games that we know, and it's going to start ramping up slowly yet surely until by the time your Halos and your Gears come out on PlayStation, it's like, okay, yeah, no, that's usually what happens. So to me, it's I think the analogy I use is like when you're like how to boil a frog. It's like you don't just throw it into hot water. You just slowly start.
He's right.
And that's what I was going to say, Bit. That was, if you notice what Phil said in there, which I found interesting, and I don't think a lot of people called this out, is he kept like reiterating, well, these games are a year old.
Yeah.
Why do you have to keep making that point? It's like you're trying to let people know it's not that bad, guys. Like these have been out for a while.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that's why I feel like Xbox is using, you know, the similar strategy that PlayStation is using with PC. It's like, hey, this is going to help cover some of our development costs for, you know, X, Y, and Z game. So that we could keep pushing Game Pass, we could keep pushing these games on our platform. And the risk is, well, people will wait until a year, you know, until all the bugs and all that stuff is ironed out.
That's exactly what they're kind of, they're slow dripping it in there. That's exactly what it is. And I saw someone saying that, I can't remember who said it, but somebody said what PlayStation's doing with their titles with PC, that's what Xbox is probably, you have to say probably, don't speak in absolutes, but they're probably doing that same thing with their games going third party, right? Absolutely. I'll speak in absolutes, he said.
Hey, Mooch.
Yeah.
Mooch, real quick. I'm glad Mac brought this up because now I'm like reading this stuff from like 10 years ago, 9 years ago. He was asked in an interview, Phil Spencer, will all first party Microsoft games release on both Windows and Xbox One moving forward? I'm not going to read the whole response, but this part stood out to me. Our intent is where genres and creative make sense in both spaces, that will put the game in both spaces. And you see us doing that already. But I don't want to make it some kind of artificial mandate because I think we end up with a Franken game that really wasn't meant for a certain platform because some suit said, hey, everything's got to run on both platforms. All that. The irony there. You end up with something people don't want. You should expect it when it looks like a game belongs on both platforms, but I wouldn't go so far as to say it's a mandate for the studio. And what happened? Everything went day and date on PC.
That's right.
Exactly.
That's right.
And what do you think is going to happen now?
In
3 years, 4 years?
It's not going to change. It's going to be the same formula.
The irony, because some suit said, like the suits made this decision.
Yes.
There's
a civil war. I can tell you absolutely with an absolute fact that there is a civil war going on internally in Microsoft.
Well, Amy Hood wants her money back.
And I can tell you that the Bethesda and ABK employees, who I've spoken to some,
they're not happy. Actually,
They're not happy at all about the direction that they're going, because they're it's unclear, and I talked about this before, they're unclear as their financial compensation goes for the future, because the way that their pay structure used to go is they got their salary, got everything else, and then they would get bonuses and so forth and other kind of compensations based on the performance of the games. Now they're walking into a company that's basically giving them away on a service, and then some of them, not all of them, we don't know which, we don't know who, we don't know when, we don't know why, games are going to go onto other platforms here, there, and everywhere. And so they're concerned. I'm not saying that they're not going to get paid. Some asshole completely misquoted me in a media article. Some video
I
game.
I saw program. That. Yeah,
it pissed me right off, and I said, "Dude, I literally did not say that."
I saw that.
I said, "They're concerned." Yeah, you said I saw you saw that, Brad, because you were talking about it, and they actually, and I said to the, and I said, "No, that's not what they said." I said they're concerned about it because they did not get clear answers, and then they had a town hall meeting, and you know what the town hall meeting was about? Instead of addressing that situation, the town hall meeting, they started saying, "We're gonna put Xbox on all available screens," and the staff were like, "This is not the question. These aren't the answers." We asked questions about. They didn't even address them, and so people are getting pissed. Now listen, at the end of the day, I said it on XNC, I said it everywhere else, I said when all else fails, and if all else fails, they may not, they'd be just fine, Xbox will be just fine, they'll continue doing their thing. I'm not saying they're done, okay?
No, but they're not.
They're not done. But no. The contingency plan was always going to be, if we're going to spend $80 billion, we're going to be the new Tencent.
That's right.
That's all there is to it. And that's so right. If they don't make it in the future, and then maybe not after next gen or the gen after that, they just said, we'll just be Tencent and we'll make billions of dollars. And that was always the plan. But the problem is they're not being upfront and honest. They don't have to tell us everything. Okay, because you know we're just consumers at the end of the day. But the problem is that you're being deceitful in the way that you're doing it, and it's rubbing people the wrong way, and people are walking away.
So let me.
And that's a problem.
So Mag, you made some great points. I got a couple of super chats here, and then I want to hear what Jack's got to say, because one of these questions from the Great Sin Vendetta. But I do want to give the flowers where they belong to these great super chats. Shout out to the great Domino's. He always says Rebirth hype super chat works. It's working. It's a miracle. Thank you guys, each and every one of you. Babor Contri's here, and Babor is very upset tonight. Babor says, F this PC shit. You know it's going to kill the console. I have zero reasons to purchase a PS6 early access machine like PS5 has been. Babor, don't be upset. We're going to get to that topic a little later on. The Melodic Punk is here. He says, who's yelling? Nintendo, baby. He's a big Nintendo fan. Shout out to Melodic Punk. MegaClub47 says, you guys think that Microsoft has given up on this gem? We're going to get into that, Mega. I think the top level answer would be they haven't given up, but just the amount of effort that's going to be going forward is it's still in question. Domino Zero says, how are Pulse Elite on the portal, Mooch? I'll get into Pulse Elites. Jez, the great Jez 7780 from Grind My Gearhouse is going to be joining us second hour, and we'll be talking a little bit more about the headset. Domino, Sin Vendetta. Now here, I'm going to read Sin Vendetta's super chat, and Jack, you heard what Mag said. You've heard what Brad said. Let me read Sin's super chat here, and I want to get your take. This is interesting because this is what I believe Xbox is probably going to try and rest their morals on, and I don't know if it's going to work. He says, every Xbox exclusive game will eventually be on every platform, with Game Pass being the big incentive to play that game in the Xbox ecosystem. So, Jack, we've heard this for years now. Nothing new here. At this point, when we're seeing the numbers, and they just released 34 million Game Pass. Now, that number includes Xbox Live members now. That number is trickling. It is barely going up. It's definitely not meeting the numbers that you see the other streaming services. And I'm not even talking about in gaming. You see Disney saying that their number, they can't even keep their numbers, and they're well over like 200 million. My point being is this. Jack, what do you think of what's transpired in the last 48 hours, what we heard about the Xbox podcast, and do you think that Xbox can rely on Game Pass now that we know where Game Pass is and how the audience has kind of responded to it?
Well, firstly, I want to say, as far as the Xbox podcast, man, it's just funny, bro. Like, y'all just said, I don't understand how, and I was watching, like, the Iron Lord, shout out to them, the homies. Mm-hmm. But, like, King David, right? I don't see how you could be worried about the rumors and then see that podcast and be like, oh, whew, that's a relief. Like, bro, they're clearly going, they're trying to go fully third party, and like, bro, how do you not see what's going on? They've done this before. They're going to keep doing it. We was talking about this on Twitter, like, the absolutes. We were just talking about this. Speaking of absolutes. Phil always do that, bro. It's four. It's only the four. Then right after that, he said, well, you know, We ain't ruled out the other ones, but right now it's the four. Like, yeah. Come on, brother. You just said it was only going to be four, man. So I think they definitely trying to go full third party. We see it. The writing's on the wall. As far as Game Pass, I'm not a businessman, but it looks like the Game Pass the Game Pass situation look like it's failing a little bit, man. And if it was as successful as people claiming online, they wouldn't be putting their games on the Nintendo Switch and the PlayStation. That way. So gameplay is clearly is not working. But I do agree with the super chat you just got. I think they're gonna try to so Game Pass exclusive 6 months to a year. That time is probably going to shrink for those who like the PlayStation games on PC. The time is going to shrink. It's going to end up being like 3 months exclusive to Game Pass day one. Then it's going to be on everything else. How I see it going.
So you think so? So let me go over to B. B, I got to tell you. So I'm right there with Jack. I'm honestly right there with Jack. And that latter part is because we just learned about this, last week in the rumors up a month ago with them going third party and putting games out. And like Jack said, the interview with The Verge right after they did the Xbox podcast. And it was comical, Jack, because he's like, only these four games. And then literally The Verge, the article comes out and he goes, but we're not going to count out. Right. We're not going to count out. In the
right after that. That was crazy.
Like, it was minutes after.
People still acted obtuse about that movie. They were like, that's not really what it means. It's like,
I was like, what are we talking about? Man. I mean, at least wait a week before that article comes out or do the article. I mean, it was like minutes. But B, you've been saying this for a long time. And I do want to, Jack, actually, he had like a hidden dagger in there, which I loved. He says, with Sony and PlayStation games, we're going to talk about that too. I want to get both sides of this coin here. So we're going to come back to what Jack was just saying. But B, where are you on that? Is Game Pass enough at this point, B, for them to say, that's why you want to buy, the reason you want to buy an Xbox right now is because we offer you Game Pass and you're going to get the games there first. Is that enough?
Coach, are people buying Xboxes right now?
No.
No, they're not. So it's not going to matter if that's the only place you can get these games at a lower price point when they start releasing them day and date, because that is going to happen. I've been saying this for a long, very long time. People don't care about Xbox. It's just the truth. If you look at the past generations, the sales have been lower and lower each generation. Mm. It's just the truth. Game Pass is not a big enough incentive. People will wait for the games, and I think they learned a lot from having Starfield on Game Pass, and they're going to learn even more once they put Call of Duty on Game Pass.
Yep.
Because people got to think, if you look at the highest sales sold games on Xbox, they're all Call of Duty games.
Yep.
Every year. Even old Call of Duty games, those are top-selling games on Xbox. So once you make those games available in a subscription, what happens? Revenue is gone.
That's right.
B-Money, that's not even a definitive. Did you see that last interview with Phil where he said, we intend to put Call of Duty on Game Pass eventually? Right. What the hell does that mean, right?
And that's what I have in one of my other topics tonight. Meg, I'm glad you brought up a B. You can answer that. Is here we are. Yeah, he was asked about Call of Duty. He didn't guarantee it. He said, we intend. They now own that. So there's two things here. They're either going to put it in the highest tier Game Pass, or they're not going to put it in Game Pass day one. I don't know. I'm speculating. I don't know.
Well, we saw what they just did with the Dead Island 2. It's in the highest tier of Game Pass, right?
Which one now?
Yeah, it's in Game Pass Ultimate. You can only
play Dead Island 2 is only released in Game Pass Ultimate.
Right, yeah.
So they're setting a precedent now to where maybe certain games will only be on Game Pass Ultimate. Oh, so absolutely. if they're doing that this early in the year.
It should have been a core game, right? As well, right?
Right.
I mean, talk about how they set core up. Yeah.
Right. But it's not. So, I mean, we still have the June showcase of when Xbox does, their next major talking. Yep. They could come out and say Game Pass's price is increasing.
Yep.
Because of this, that, or the third. This is where you'll be able to find, Activision Blizzard games, we don't know how they're going to roll it out. But we know that eventually Call of Duty is going to be in Game Pass. People are not going to, it's not going to be the highest selling game anymore. I've talked about this on BRAP for years now. Since they talk about purchasing Activision, Call of Duty is no longer going to be the highest selling game every year, because you're going to knock off half the sales by having it in a subscription where people don't have to buy it.
Yeah.
And that's why they say intend, because if there's one thing that they don't want to break, it's the thing that, you know, made Activision Blizzard a $70 billion close to purchase, right? It's like they still don't know what the hell they're doing with it, which is kind of frightening to think. It's it's again, it's the weird communication by Xbox. It's weird. And you know, the fact that we don't know anything about, you know, the what's happening with the ABK games for the most part, besides Diablo, is just going to tell you that it's not going to be, you know, the rainbow and sunshines that, like, you know, every other person wants to tell you it's going to be. It's going to come with a lot of changes that are going to be not favorable. You know,
Mr. Babbitt, you said that. Mr. B Money just said it. Jack alluded to it. You know, the thing about it with Game Pass is they just announced they did a stealth drop today, and I'll use this because it's a good game to use as an example, and I think the audience will appreciate it because we always talk in hypotheticals. Dead Island 2 shadow dropped today. I've owned Dead Island 2 since the day it came out. I don't know how long ago it came out. I don't know if it was 6 months ago, 8 months ago. I don't know. If someone wants to look it up, let me know. Was it a while? Yeah, at least I'm in the ballpark. I didn't want it to be like a month ago. I knew it was a while ago. And, you know, it's like, who's waiting? Like, who's waiting? You know, I don't know who's waiting that long. But if that game, and I looked it up, I believe it's $38 on the Xbox store. I guys, you can double check me and, you know, check my numbers on that. $38 right now on sale for the Ultimate Edition of that to buy that and own it. You know, right. And it's like, who's Diablo? They mentioned that Diablo drop in the Xbox podcast. And like they said, it was like, it was kind of like Mag uses this all the time. It's like a fart in the wind. It was just like, poof. Nobody really even, we're not even really talking about it. Everybody's already bought the game and is playing it. I own it on Xbox and I own it on Blizzard. I bought it on PC too. Like my point is, if you want to play these games, you're going to play these games when you want to play them. Who's going to put down, let's say right now you're into Helldivers 2. You got Final Fantasy Rebirth coming out in a week, okay? God bless. And all of a sudden, you're going to put that down. You're like, oh my God, Dead Island 2 launched today. I'm not playing those games. Of course you're not playing Dead Island 2.
Well, it's kind of like going to the Diablo part and like Sarah Bond talk about the next console. If they're telling you a whole big nothing burger and they're hinting at like, yeah, you know, the rumors are pretty right. But here's these shiny keys, and we're going to jingle them in front of you. Look at Diablo. Wasn't this a great game? And look, we're making the most powerful, the most generational leap console. It's like, guys, who the hell cares? the Xbox Series X, way more powerful than the PS5, from whatever your engineer tells me on Twitter. It doesn't matter because every developer codes for the most dominant console on the market. It's the PlayStation 5. And so all of a sudden, the teraflips, the teraskips that we were talking about, arguing over for, you know, RDNA 3.5, whatever the fuck it's called. It doesn't matter. It doesn't. And it never did, because it's always going to be coded for the most popular piece of hardware, which it tends to be on PlayStation. So to me, that whole talk was enlightening, because it's the philisms. I'm gonna say it without saying it. I'm gonna jingle these keys in front of you. Philism. Now is everybody okay? We're everybody's all right. Okay, we'll see you in 6 months. We have a showcase. Let's jingle them.
Here's the thing.
You know the funny thing about that showcase? Wait till that showcase. Every game announced is gonna have an asterisk next to it.
Sure.
Yep.
Every game announcing, because they're going to go, it's going to be a big trailer and explosions and all this other bullshit. And then they're going to go, coming out this, and everybody's going to go, but coming out on what? Right? And then the next game. And then they're going to go, awesome, but coming out on what?
I mean, look, like Blade. I had someone in our chat going, well, it's not confirmed, whatever. It's like, no.
No.
If I was Xbox, I'd have that. Blade and then an Xbox emblem shortly afterwards. It's not bad there. Bit. That's because they haven't decided on
Tom Warren fall. Point blank asked Phil Spencer
if
Starfield and Indiana Jones would be exclusive. He did not shoot that down at all. He did not say no.
No. He said they're not part. He gave the most corporate answer I've ever heard. And I was pissed when I heard it. He said no. And then he paused and said, they're not part of the four games. I'm like, oh, okay, so they could be five and six. or they could be 6 and 7, or they could be 7 and 8, or they could be 9 and 10. You never said no, period. He just said no. They're not part of the first four games. And once again, I want to bring up people's listening comprehension skills. People attacking me on Twitter going, how does the L taste, Mag? He said they're staying exclusive. And I'm like, no, he didn't. But okay, enjoy the moral victory. But
these people, not only can they not listen, their comprehension's bad. They can't read either. Because if they read that interview with Tom Warren, they would have seen Phil Spencer not even address the question head on. Didn't even deny it.
And he said, not part of the first four games. He never said no, period. And then, like an hour and a half later, a podcast was showing up saying, Phil Spencer confirms Starfield and Indiana Jones are not going to PlayStation. And I'm like, what? When did he say these things?
Can I piggyback off something you said about, like, listening skills? Go. This is a problem within certain facets of the Xbox community, certain influencers of the Xbox community, content creators, pundits, if you will, when Tim Stewart at the Wells Fargo event came out and said that they were going to pivot their strategy.
Yes.
You know, put their That's games the on rival platforms. To. Yes. But you know what they said? They obfuscated what he said. Oh no, he meant ABK. No, actually he didn't. It was a two-part question. If you listen to the audio, he clearly discusses ABK and also discusses first party. And here we are today. Everything he said was true. Like, can we just stop with the obfuscating of what the C-suite is saying? Like, it's maddening, to your point, Mag, about people not being able to listen.
And then, like, you get the Phil, again, like, the Phil article afterwards of, like, him coming out going, hey, guys, look at the keys. We're jingling them. Don't forget what Tim Stewart
Why
said.
Why is he jingling keys, Mr. Batman?
Because the Twitter community.
That's what you do to get a baby attention when you're taking a photo. You
know? Jingle, jingle. And, like, the gaming community falls for it. It's like, oh, man, Phil, look at you wear that T-shirt of, like, you know, Battletoads. He gets it. He's one of us. It's like he's jingling the keys. And Tim Stewart saying the thing out loud.
Look at his shelves, guys. Look at his shelves.
Exactly. Look at the shelves.
Yeah, look at the shelves. Satya Nadella himself said, I don't like exclusives. You remember that when he was in court?
Yeah. He's like, I don't like it. Doesn't make sense.
And man, what did everybody say when he was saying, oh, he's not a gamer? He's admitted he's not a gamer. And then the minute the ABK thing jumped off, it was like, he's like on the video, well, let us compete. And Sachi's behind it now. He's all about it. You know, Phil's in there talking to him, and he's with it. I'm like, he's still looking at him.
Yeah. Eric, is that you're absolutely right. I remember when he said that, people are freaking out, going, he's not a gamer. He doesn't know. I'm like, no, he's just the CEO of the company.
He's just
like,
the one that makes the decisions. No say
where his money goes.
So here's another point.
I said here on Crossfire, one of the last times I was here, I said, maybe the fanboys, maybe you guys should listen to the guy that talks about the money, because the money will always win.
You always follow the money. You always follow the money.
Follow the money. And what were we told, Mooch? Well, Phil came out. Do you remember Phil came out shortly after that and put his little spin on it? Yep. And that's who they went to.
That's right. That's right. And
I know it's like, one of these days you guys are going to learn that, okay, Phil may be a cool dude to have a beer with, but Phil Spencer has self-preservation. Why? Because Phil Spencer has a pretty damn good high-paying job, a job that he likes.
That's right.
A family to take care of.
He's got bills.
And a company line to tote.
If I may, because I got a little short time here. When we listen to Hiroki Totoki, we have to keep that same energy. He is the CFO. He is all about the money. He's looking at the margins, and he's going, well, something's got to give. Naughty Dog, you don't have producers? Well, you will now. Like, they're, you know, they...
Yeah, hey, talk about it.
That's right. Like, the math ain't mathing.
Exactly. The math's not mathing, and it's catching up to us.
Operational efficiency.
He's saying it out loud. He doesn't need to say it on a podcast going, hey, guys, kumbaya. No, he's saying, hey, listen, we need to expand our content on other platforms besides our own, being cloud, being mobile, being PC. We need to find a way to get our games onto these other platforms while still keeping them and making them central on this hub that makes us money, which is the PlayStation 5, right?
That's right.
So he's like, who can do that? Who could do that tango?
Mr. Babbitt, that's what the CEO just said too. Yoshida, Kenichiro Yoshida said the same thing.
It's like, guys, from what I've seen, PlayStation's always like 3-4 years late to the game. Look at, like, back in what, 2019, Xbox was talking about the cloud. It was talking about bringing its games onto PC, and we're all like, boo, Xbox, what are you doing? And now it's normal, It's like it's something that we're like, yeah, of course, like the Xbox exclusive of the month is going to be on PC too. It's just it's part of their ecosystem, whatever. That now they've normalized it. So now when PlayStation starts limiting the hey, maybe Horizon, you know, comes out instead of in 2 years afterwards, maybe it comes out a year afterwards. Or
I mean, Herman Hulse actually said that already.
Yes.
Yeah. By the way, Hulse said that they're not going to take 2 years anymore. He said they're going to try to shoot for a year.
And I've gotten a lot of PlayStation fanboys upset. They're like, oh, they can't hire all the. Yeah, they will. Like, look at the for hiring pages of like Sucker Punch, Santa Monica. All the PlayStation studios are looking for people that have backgrounds in PC stuff. So like the stuff I don't understand of like, hey, do you guys know how to work with NVIDIA? I know I don't, but someone is. And why are they looking for someone that knows that type of stuff?
Here's the thing, obviously, Mr. Bad, but we were talking about this before the show. And shout out to Game with Persona, Lord Metroid. I see you guys out there. Appreciate you being here. And I'll get to some of the super chats in a minute. We were talking about this before the show, Mr. Bad, but I don't know if you had heard me and Brap going back and forth. The thing is Sony, and I want to hear Jack, because Jack's been very vocal on this for probably the better part of 6 months now. Yes, PlayStation may reduce their time of exclusives, right? 12, 24 months is where they're sitting now. Maybe it'll be a little less than 12 months. But the point of the matter is this. You have to look at the blueprint that's already been out there. Xbox started doing day and date in 2016. Clearly, that hasn't worked to their advantage, or at least didn't work to what their projections were. So yeah. What I'm saying to Mr. Badbit, and he's not wrong. They are looking for people to work within their industry so that they can utilize, maybe you can have Sucker Punch and these folks making things in unison. But the point of the matter is that PlayStation's already talking about, which we're going to get into in a little while too, a Pro that's supposed to be coming out. It's almost like the worst rumor now at this point. Like everyone's been saying, Tom Henderson's been saying it for a while, a bunch of people. It's coming out later this year. There's a Pro. There's already rumors and discussions about the PS6. So, and the work that they're doing with AMD, I think we heard, shout out to Moore's Law's Dead. Like, my point being is that they're dependent on the hardware, Mr. Babbitt, Xbox is not, right? That's what they do. So, my point being is that they want to continue to have that. They want to continue to have that stream of money coming through on the hardware. Then they can double dip afterwards and make it on PC. It's definitely going to come to PC. That's without a doubt.
Yeah, and like when you take a look at all like the blueprints and the schematics, the trademarks that they're filing, it's like they're looking for people that can make a PC storefront. They're looking for people that can manage cloud gaming. You know, they're looking for people that can, you know, do things with mobile. It's like they're looking into it right now. The benefit that Sony has that Xbox doesn't is that their console is extremely popular, right? That their company is a little bit healthier than Xbox's. Yes. And when I say a little bit, I mean a lot of bit. Mm-hmm. And they are not pressed for time the way that Xbox is. That's why when I hear people going, oh, Nintendo's gonna start making games on PC. Okay, yeah, maybe that'll happen when Mario Kart doesn't sell 75 plus million units. Like,
that's what I was saying, Bad, but there's no rush.
There's no rush. Yeah. And you know, the hardware that they're using, Nintendo was geniuses after the GameCube and even the Wii U, which is like, why are we trying to compete with PlayStation and Xbox on the graphic front? We know we can't. What are we really good at? Family games. And they're like, so we don't need to make, you know, Mario's hat. You don't need it 4K and see all the goddamn individual stitching. You just need a fun Mario game and something good for the kids. And kids are not going to care if something runs at 60 or 120 FPS. So like Nintendo has, I think, just saw something 20 years into the future back in the early 2000s and went, yeah, no, we can own this part of the market. And now look, they are the kings of the family. Like that is the family console. That's what, you know, many kids are yearning for. It's for like a Switch or an iPad. And so like they're not pressed for time because these games that are much cheaper to develop, right, are selling 40, 50, 60, 70 million units. And so they're not pressed for time whatsoever. Is Sony pressed for time? A little bit, but it's not like this, oh God, doom or gloom, this is happening right now today. It's like, okay, we see in 4 or 5 years, the way we're currently doing it is going to catch up to us. So how do we stay ahead? And right. Xbox is like, hey, the future is now. We just spent over $70 billion mm-hmm. for both Bethesda and Activision, and mom and dad want to see the return on investment right now. You know, that's why I never really believe folks of like, you know, you don't pay X amount of money to keep things exclusive, or sorry, to keep things everywhere. It's like, no, you actually, you actually keep that gravy train going. You actually need to see more of it. It's not like Microsoft's like, hey, we just want you guys to make $70 billion back. They're like, no, we want you to make $140 billion on this. Some type of number that sounds stupid, because it is, because they want to see a big ROI on what is one of the biggest acquisitions in the history of just doing this shit.
Yeah.
So, you know, a long ran over. Everybody's fine at the end of the day. It's just the landscape's changing a little bit, and everybody's a little freaked out by the change. Thank you for the TED Talk, and now I gotta go.
That's great, Mr. Babbitt. It's awesome. Shout out to Mr. Babbitt. Thanks for being here, buddy. Yes. I appreciate it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you. Again, check me out. The Trophy Room. You know where
yes,
it is. You know
the where to go. Love outstanding you all very much. Show, Mr. Babbitt. Thank you.
Mr. Babbitt.
Next time I won't double buck, y'all.
No, that's all right, buddy. We'll get you back. We know me. I'll probably bother you in a week or so. The great Mr. Babbitt.
Hey, Mooch, when you get a moment, I want to piggyback off something Mr. Babbitt said.
No, that's fine. I wanted to just go ahead and make this point. Aaron in the chat, you know, he says, you know, he's all over the place, but he says, you know, so what's Mooch's point on the games that come to PS Plus? Guys, we're here every week. I don't talk about PS Plus or tell you that. Let's say Helldiver, like Helldivers 2, right? It's a Sony owned game. What if I told you guys, I'm not buying that. I'm gonna sit here and wait for it to come to PS Plus. That's the equivalent, Aaron, of what you do. I'm not doing that. I wanted to play the game. I bought the game. I'm not gonna wait and see if Sony's gonna put it in PS Plus a year from now, 2 years from now, 6 months from now. I want to play the game. And that goes for any of the games. I'm just picking that one out of thin air because that's a game you could say, oh, that's a $40 title. Maybe that's one day that'll come to PS Plus. Okay. Maybe it will. But I'm not going to wait on it. It's just the way it is. So when I see that type of talk, that doesn't make a whole lot of sense to me. Brap, go ahead if you want to piggyback. Then I want to ask Jack a question.
Yeah, I just want to piggyback something Mr. Babbitt said. You know, Sony, I'm going to reference something Max said earlier. Sony's been playing the tip game and other areas of the industry markets for many, many years. Like them talking about other devices isn't new. If you go back and you think about PlayStation, remember the PlayStation TV subscription service? That was a thing. They had the PlayStation app. They used to have that on Bravia televisions. They had a PlayStation cell phone. They had the Vita, they had the PSP, they just made the, what's it called, the PlayStation, oh gosh, why am I forgetting the device now?
The Portal,
thank you.
Yes.
You know, Cloud, they bought Gaikai like 11 years ago. They had PlayStation Now before there was Game Pass. I mean, so they have been doing these things for years. So when I hear people say, oh, this is all new for them. No, it actually isn't. It may be a little more accelerated per se. They may be like investing more, but they have tried to expand their reach in different markets previous to what we're hearing them discuss today. None of this is really new. And this is why I'm not like, oh my God, they're going to, you know, the sky's falling with PlayStation, you know, call Hillary. Something's going on. You're like, you know, like I'm not freaking out because I also understand like this is what businesses do. Like we talk about Hiroki Totoki, and he put Bungie on blast. Like, hey, you guys got to rein in your discretionary spending. You know,
yeah,
we got to create operational efficiencies. I mean, that's his job. That's what he's supposed to do. So that's all I wanted. I just wanted to piggyback off. That's all I want to say. I want to piggyback on what Mr. Babbitt said. Can we
appreciate Hiroki Totoki's name as like the Julia Gulia of the gaming world? I'm sorry. Yeah. I can't get over the name, man. Sorry. Carry on.
Glenn Gulia.
So, Jack, I want to ask Jack, because, Jack, listen, everybody wants to hear the other side of the coin, and it is Crossfire, so I want to talk about the other side. Jack, you've been very vocal on some of the things that you've been, I don't want to use the word disappointed. Maybe that's too strong. I'll let you use your own words. But you've been somewhat critical of some of the moves that have gone on Sony's side. And, you know, when it comes to either day and date or what we saw today going on with the PlayStation VR 2 being looked into, at least being some of the PlayStation, or pardon me, the PC VR games are going to be accessible now on PSVR2 by the end of this year. Doesn't necessarily mean that the first party ones are going to go to PC, but PC players will say absolutely, and you really can't argue with that. There's definitely probably going to be a little give and take there. Jack, what do you think about the PlayStation model and how long they'll hold up with the way that they're going? You heard what Brad said. You heard Meg. You heard Mr. Badbit. You heard me. Where are you on this? Because you're very vocal on this online.
Yeah, I am. I think, honestly, bro, if you want my 100% yes. honest opinion, I think they want to go day and date. I think they want to go day and date, and I think we see day and date. If not, very soon, it's definitely going to be, by the time PS6, it's going to be day and date, bro. Like, we see the writing on the wall. I don't agree with it. Y'all know I don't agree with it. Apparently, you know, selling 15, 20, sometimes upwards of 30 million copies of a game is not enough. Color me surprised, right? So, you know, Spider-Man selling 30 million, it ain't enough money for them. So they got to put it on PC. It is what it is at this point. My problem with the PSVR, it's funny, right? Because it's a two-pronged situation. So The way I see it, since it's already happened, I'm like, fuck it, right? So I feel like PSVR should have never been tied to the PS5. It doesn't make sense. And I said this on Twitter a few months ago. It doesn't make sense to tether someone to your console by way of the PSVR, but not the actual exclusive software. Because if we're looking at the PSVR, right? I don't own a PSVR. I wanted to get one, but it doesn't have PSVR1 backwards compatibility. Mm-hmm. They didn't patch many of the games to work with it. As of right now, it doesn't have a compelling software lineup overall from people I know that have it, including, you know what I mean? So that on top, I'm getting a phone call right now. What the hell? I lost my train of thought. Got a fucking phone call. It don't got a compelling software right now as it is. And Sony hasn't really been showing upcoming games. Matter of fact, one of the exclusives they did have, Firewalk, I believe, the goddamn studio closed down. So it's like, it should have been on PC day one. You see what I'm saying? But I definitely think they want to do day one. Me personally, I don't like the idea. I didn't like the idea of PC when they originally with the PS Now. You got to remember, PS Now was not native. It was always digitally streaming cloud gaming. I was cool with PS Now being everywhere, all screens, whatever. Every screen's a PlayStation, I guess, right? You get it? So I was cool with that. But as soon as it became like a native situation, I wasn't feeling it, bro. I wasn't feeling what they was doing with it. That's just me.
Well, I mean, but Jack, no, so just I want to expand on it a bit because I want to think about it as far as the business model, too. So, you know, I've just been a firm believer that Nintendo and PlayStation they're dependent on their hardware sales, right? The PlayStation makes a big deal. They had the Slim model. They got a Pro coming out. Like, they got the talk of the PS6 is happening. So, like, while this is happening, they're clearly not leaving the console space. Jack, it's already kind of on paper that by taking Xbox games and putting them on PC day and date, it's a lot of Xbox gamers, and they're in my chat. A lot of Xbox guys are here. Shout out to all the guys that are here. I appreciate it. You know, they're like, well, Mooch, I went and I built a rig. I built a PC. Okay. So, what I'm saying to you is that's why... Mr. Badbit, Jack, you were saying the numbers continue to decline. B Money said it. The numbers are declining. So here's the thing, Jack. What I'm saying to you is my only rebuttal is if that's the case, and I do see the blueprint you're laying out, I see it. But if that's the route they go, there will be less PS5s and less PS6s purchased in the future. We're seeing it. It's happening in front of our eyes. The Xbox One was the worst Xbox generation known to Xbox, right? And this one is coming in less. They're selling less. So I'm just
exactly.
So how can Sony, who wants to sell hardware and want to be that dominant force, do that when they go day and date? I could see the 12 months. I could see making all of them 1 year. Let everybody know. 1 year, I get that. You can even go as far as to say 6 months. That's fine because the hardcore is not waiting 6 months to play a game they want to play. They'll double dip. But to go day and date, I would say that PlayStation might have the same issues that Xbox did, and they may lose some of that money. And when you have a console, Brap was saying this before the show. I'll give credit to Brap, and Brap was reading it, and he was talking and discussing this with other people over the course of the past few days. When you have the console, Jack, you're buying the software, the games. You're buying, right, 100%. You don't have to get anything physical there. You're getting every time you buy a movie off their store, anytime you're using an Apple app, anytime you're doing anything over there, they'll get a piece of that. Losing that revenue, losing that box, loses them money in other categories besides just gaming software. I don't necessarily see it. I do think that eventually it may happen, but I think when that does happen, I think it's when they want to weed themselves out of the console business. Like Xbox said, we don't want to be, we don't care where you buy our games. They don't care. They said you don't have to buy our console. Guess what? People didn't. So, like, Sony's not saying that. Sony's every day on our feed is, you know, don't forget PS5. Don't forget the PS5. Have you seen the PS5? You know, like, every day. Xbox doesn't care. They're like, they're advertising PC. Yeah. They got the console out there. They got a phone in your face. You know what I mean? It's like, it's always something. Yeah. And I think that's my question, Jack. Do you see, does that hold water that maybe this would elongate a little bit into the, at least the PS6 era? Or no, you really think PS6, that's it, drop it?
Well, I would like to say I agree with everything you just said, right? And when you said that, that's really my, that was my main complaints about games going to PC at all, right? Like that doesn't make sense to me. I believe in exclusivity with gaming, and every time you give consumers another reason not to buy your platform, it's dumb as hell to me, right? That's why I have problems with Xbox. But clearly, in Jim Ryan, I cannot stand Jim Ryan. I think he's a piece of shit personally. He seemed like a cool guy, but as far as like, he a cutthroat dude, right? Good businessman.
Yes.
And this Hiroki Totoki, cat like Jim Ryan times 10 or something like that. Right? So we already see how Jimbo was moving. So Hiroki, like, man, hey, put that shit like on Debo. PC, bro. I see it, bro.
No, you know what, though, to your point, Jack, and I didn't, my stance on this switched from how I thought about this years ago. Because I didn't think there would be cannibalization of Xbox hardware. But I think what we're seeing is, I should say think, and I've talked to some other people in the industry today who were like, yeah, the Xbox cannibalized probably close to half of their hardware base by putting games day and date on PC. And, you know, Sony's a consumer electronics manufacturer. I think the one thing that Sony does well, they know how to market their hardware to consumers. I think that's, they're good at that, right? They also, because they're a hardware company, and because they generate a lot of revenue, that PlayStation 5 console is a conduit to everything else in terms of revenue. I don't see them putting games on on PC day and date, unless they can find a suitable replacement for the amount of revenue that they're going to lose from the loss of a PlayStation 5 or PlayStation 6 hardware console sale. Because it isn't just the $500 that Sony reaps. It's like what you said, Mooch. It's the sales of first party games, they get 100% of that. The third party stuff, they get 30% of all that.
Yep.
We know how much they make off Call of Duty. They make billions off Call of Duty, just the 30% for not even doing anything. It's the easiest like way to make money. They do nothing but put the game on their storefront, collect 30%, and then actually it's less than that now because Kotick negotiated a more favorable deal. But you know, there's also the other stuff they get, the licensing, when you buy movies, all the ancillary stuff, revenue that's generated in that box. And so if the math doesn't math, and I said this earlier today, people are like, oh, it just makes sense. More games everywhere. No, guys, the math needs to make sense. Like that they need to sell enough copies of enough software on PC day and date to recoup that revenue loss from not selling hardware, because there will be a cannibalization effect. We saw that with Xbox, and it goes deeper than that. When you start selling less hardware, the economies of scale and the supply chain don't work in your favor, because now you're spending more to buy more parts to make video game consoles because you're not making enough, you're not selling enough, and you're not getting that deal that you got, because the more you buy in bulk, the better deal you get. Now you're scaling back. Now you're paying more money. I mean, there's like a domino effect in terms of increased costs. It's counterintuitive.
I agree with everything you're saying. Let me ask you a question, because we already know.
Yeah.
We already got proof of both of this. Take Two wants to raise game prices again.
Yep. Yes, and that's gonna happen.
And Sony definitely damn sure wanted it. They came out in the leaked documents. I see games going to $80 to $100.
Oh, absolutely.
I'm saying sooner than later, though. Like, I can see that happening.
Absolutely. Jack, I mean, we see this with other, like, consumer products, right? When the cost goes up, what do? They always stick the increase of cost to consumers.
Yep.
They always, and so I'm telling, like, people are going to, like, flip out. This is going to happen. And again, people are going to be like, oh, Brian's advocating for more, you know, corporation. No, I'm not. I'm just saying, like, the reality is when the costs go up, the cost is usually passed to consumers. So you have a choice. You can either not buy the game at launch, wait for it to go on sale, or go down to your local GameStop, visit my buddy Gaming Forte, trade in a couple games, you know, and use that trading credit for an $80, $90 game. But I don't disagree with you, Jack. I think that's going to happen. But I think what people are missing here is that this is more complex than just more games everywhere means more revenue. It's not that simple. There's a lot of the math needs to math. And, you know, if they're going to cannibalize hardware sales and all that revenue that hardware generates, they need to be able to make that up in the PC side. And where do you sell your PC? I mean, where do you sell your PC software? You're selling it on Steam. So you're giving Steam a 30% cut. If you go to Epic, you're giving them a 30% cut. If you decide to create a PC launcher, that's an additional cost. There's
people going to rebel against that PC launcher, too. You already know what they're going to do.
Oh, yeah.
Them PC dudes going to rebel against that.
Oh, Jack, I bought Halo Infinite on Steam, and I had Game Pass because the game kept crashing on me. And then after that, I refused to buy games or download. There were certain games I was like, no, I'm just going to buy it on Steam because I don't trust the game to run well on the Game Pass launcher. Like, it just... Yeah, and you're right. Like, people, PC guys, I said PC guys, PC players in general, like consumers, they love Steam. They love Steam. Mm-hmm. They trust the ecosystem. They like the UI. They love it. Like, Steam is, Gabe Newell's their best friend. That's hard to keep, and they got their digital libraries. It's hard to pull people away from that. And the other thing I was going to mention, too, when we talk about Hiroki Totoki, people saying, oh, you know, what he said means, you know, PC day and date. He's talking about increasing operation profit or increasing profit margins. When you add additional development costs, which is what would happen when you develop games simultaneously with the console, you have to hire more people. It's more of a lift. Mm-hmm. That's more money. That's counterintuitive to what Totoki's talking about, because you're adding additional expense.
Yeah. Yeah.
No, so that's all I have to say about
no, that's fine. But Meg, I want to get you in this. Meg, this is the other side of the coin. Yeah. You definitely went off and you gave great points on the Xbox side of what happened, what transpired over the last 2 weeks and the rumors that were going on for the last 4 to 6 weeks. But,
right.
You know, Meg, you've heard Jack, you heard his concerns, you heard Brap, and he kind of gave the financial statements on both sides of it. I mean, you heard my rant on just what we're seeing. I'm only looking at the data that we have in front of us, and what has happened since 2016 to today has shown a decline in Xbox console sales, a decline in Xbox game sales. So is it in, where's, there's of course an incentive to be on PC. I've always called it the double dip, Meg. You know, you've listened to me for a long time.
Right.
The double dip seemingly works. It's the same thing. Like, Meg, I mean, you're in the restaurant business. I mean, you get it. You have a recipe. If I want to buy what you're selling, I have to wait for you to do one of two things. Let me into the restaurant to eat it, or I have to wait until you allow a supermarket to sell your sauce. So if the supermarket's the PC community and Sony says, listen, you want to play our game, I'll just say whatever. It doesn't matter what we call it. You know, the new Last of Us 3. Well, it's going to be on PlayStation 6, and then it'll release a year later on PC. And if you're a PC gamer only, you're like, I'm not buying a console. I don't want to play it. I have an unbelievable gaming PC that can handle way more than even the PS6's future specs. Fine. My point being is that seemingly works. Sony must know that works. Why would Sony say, hey, you know, Xbox did this in 2016. It didn't work so well. Let's do that.
Yeah, you see, the thing is, that comes back to what I was saying earlier in the show when we were talking about how Sony doesn't have to. There's no urgency to what to follow Microsoft's path when it comes to business. I understand that a lot of what they're doing, they say, oh, it's the future. The cloud is the future. This is the future. That's the future. But Sony and Nintendo are still leading the way, and they're still leading the way, and they're still making the money, and they're doing everything else, and they're blowing everybody else out of the water. And the reason for that, once again, is because their business model does not need to be interrupted. However, I still feel that there's going to be some kind of like a medium, and you know, there's going to be like a halfway point here where maybe they're going to close that window a little bit. However, if they continue, once again, something I'm going to reiterate is that if they're going to continue to make compelling software, which they have for decades, their pedigree is unmatched. Therefore, people are going to get that FOMO. That FOMO, if it's going to be game of the year, if it's going to win 25 awards, it's going to do this and that, whatever. I don't know if people are going to wait, because people are going to know, you know, what are the two systems that people usually have? They have a PlayStation and a PC, right? And that seems to be more often than someone having an Xbox and a PC, right?
Right.
Or a Switch and a PC. It seems to be the partnering is usually a PlayStation and a PC. And they could play all their Xbox games and whatever else and blah, blah, blah. And maybe a smattering of Switches here and there because, you know, everybody's got a Switch at some point. It's basically become a cell phone at this point, right? Like, everybody's got their hands on it. But what I think is at the end of the day, they'll shorten the window, they'll close the window a little bit, but I absolutely do not believe that they're going to go day and date. I don't see why they would do that. I wouldn't see why they would cannibalize their future hardware or risk a business that's been working for 30 years and will continue to work. And, you know, see people say, oh, you got to catch up with the times. Coca-Cola is still bottled and sold exactly the way it was 100 years ago. It's still making billions of dollars. It'll still do the same thing now. Maybe it won't always be physical discs or this and that, whatever. But I still think at the end of the day, you're still going to have that dedicated hardware under the TV at some point. Because the problem with, you know, when people talk about this cloud stuff and all this nonsense, I'm not going to go on a tangent about that. However, I will discuss the fact that those things will never take off unless there's some kind of a universal internet system that's not based on people's affordability, right? I have the best internet in the world, literally, right? Okay, and I pay for that. There are people who cannot afford to pay for that. So how is that all going to work at the end of the day? You're not going to get the same experience I am. So therefore, it's not really a thing. I still think at the end of the day, for decades to come, we're still going to have the dedicated hardware. Sony's going to continue to do it. It's shown to be successful. And I think that PC will continue to be that double dip. I just think that they're going to close the window a little more. Once you get those first 90 days, after 90 days, those sales are done or dropped significantly. Yep. Then you could say 3 to 6 months later, maybe 6 months.
6 months would be the shortest span I think they would drop to.
Let me ask y'all a question.
Yeah, Jeff.
We seeing this with Helldivers 2 right now. You know they doing the games of service day and date.
That's right.
And Helldivers 2 is doing numbers. But once again, I'm not a mathematician. But if I'm going off of all the numbers, I'm seeing how many concurrent players has got on PC, what the servers have capped out at. If you do the math, man, it don't take a... It's doing... substantially better on PC, right? Now, maybe it's that type of game, and that's a PC gamer type game, it's
definitely a PC type, like PC type game.
Yeah, that's no doubt. Okay, so what in a... I'm trying to live in a world where I'm seeing, okay, they're constantly doing the games and service day and date releases, they're all doing numbers, and they performing well on PC.
Mm-hmm.
Does that not lean... And they don't have no competition for Xbox, because they probably gonna put all their shit day and date. They already doing it, right? So, they probably like, man... Fuck it. Why not put the shit day and date? Everybody fucking with the game servers day and date. We not seeing no adverse reaction that old buddy like to say. I can see him doing it, man. I don't agree with it. I think it's stupid personally.
Let me answer his question real quick, though.
Having the games of the service be successful would actually allow them to hold off putting their single player games on their day and date. I think they really want to stick to that one-year window, and I think, you know, with Herman Hulse coming out and saying that the games as service games would be their day and date, they want to see how that plays out and see if they can, you know, gain some, you know, large revenue from that. But they don't have the capacity to release all their games day and date on PC. Like, they would have to hire almost, you know, fully staffed teams just to do that. Yep. None of their teams are equipped to put their games on PC like that day and date. So it'll be a while before we get to that point where you know, the Last of Us and Ghost of Tsushima and all these games are hitting PC day and date.
Yeah,
they just aren't equipped to do that.
B, if I can just piggyback off that too. I just want to piggyback off what he said to answer Jack's question. Jack asked the question. It's a valid question. Jack, we say this all the time on this show. It is, you know, for every Helldivers, and by the way, shout out to everyone that's enjoying that. I'm just using it as an example because the numbers are probably low. For every Helldivers, there's 100 Foam Stars.
Oh, okay? Absolutely.
So what I'm saying, we are looking at something that you know, lightning. This might be lightning in a pan. Who knows what's going to happen here, right? My whole thing is that what B said actually makes a lot of money too, is that this allows them to have the God of Wars, the Spider-Mans, the Last of Us, the new game by Sucker Punch, the new game by Bend, to go and give the console a purpose. The other thing is multiplayer games, let's be honest, it's in the title, multiplayer. The only thing that makes a multiplayer game withstand the sands of time, it's two things. Great gameplay, Okay, if the game sucks, but it's also the population, you know, the gamers, the number of gamers. So that's something that I understand that move. This was a bit, we know this from the great Jim Ryan, you know, your buddy Jack, Jimmy, right? So Jimmy wanted to put X amount of games, right? Jimmy wanted to put X amount of games in the games as a service model. We've heard that they went from 12 to 6 to maybe less. So there's a few. I'm hoping like Concord is able to pull something off like this. I mean, but listen, if you're a betting man, you're probably not putting $1,000 down that Concord's going to do numbers like Helldivers 2. And listen, if anybody asked you a month ago if Helldivers 2 was going to do this good, you would have like, you might have laughed so hard you just left the show.
No,
so,
absolutely.
You know, so yeah. So I think B makes a
and good, Steve Sony knew that.
Right. Shout out to B too for saying what he said, because I didn't even think about this. Allows them that extra cord to be able to say, hey, you know what, we can still do our plan because we're making that extra cash over here, and then we can make our extra money on single player over there. Now, if that's what actually happens, I don't know. But I don't know. I think that kind of answers the question. And Helldivers, again, I think the day and date with games as a service, you have to have that PC crowd. You have to have more players. Because even if everybody like bought it up on PlayStation 5 right now and was playing this game, it wouldn't have the resilience. It wouldn't have the numbers, and the numbers is what gets more people. Listen, I'll tell you right now. I play every week. You guys know I'm going between Helldivers 2 on this and Call of Duty gameplay. I play a lot of Warzone, a lot. Be
nice
a
if
lot.
I can get in.
Oh, you can get in, buddy. Oh, you mean
no? Helldivers. I can't. Right. I can't. The service.
I was gonna say you want to play Warzone. I'll play
you go through activity. You go to activity cards or join.
Well, yeah,
I have the definitive version.
Yes.
Hey. Oh no, so, you mean the broken one?
It went straight to the game.
It goes right to the game. PlayStation priority.
The hype about this game though, and the number count has gotten the people that I play with on PlayStation to play exclusive. They just play Warzone. They don't listen to anything that they don't know who Jim Ryan is. They don't know any of this stuff. These are the guys I've been playing like Call of Duty with for like a better part of a decade, if not longer. They don't pay attention to any of that. They buy Madden, they buy NBA 2K, and they buy Call of Duty. That's all they buy. And they were like, hey, I see you're always on Helldivers, is that good? I did read about that. I actually looked it up because I kept seeing you on it. They picked, these are three guys that don't ever play anything but Call of Duty. They picked up Helldivers on PlayStation. So the fact that it is this big, the fact that PC is doing its job and really really putting this game on a pedestal, is just bringing more money in. So it really piggybacks off of what B Money said. Jez, welcome to the show first of
all.
Yo,
what's up, guys?
And if I don't know if you want to add anything to that,
you're gonna tag me out. I gotta get going. Jez is tagging in. So
tag in
the great Mag. Yeah, everybody. Yeah.
Oh wow! Ooh, okay.
You got me, Mooch. You did it again. 60 minutes turned into an hour and 25.
Listen, it was all part of the plan. I really can't say that I. So Mag, thanks for being here, buddy. Let everybody know they can find you.
You know where you can find me, guys. I'm all over social media, Twitter. I'm all over TikTok. You can find me on XNC on Mondays, making Colt sweat under the heat lamp when I get going on there. But you know how it goes. Anyways, you guys, it was an awesome show. Panel, you guys were amazing. Chat, you were also amazing. Loved you guys. And we'll see you guys all again sometime soon. Mooch, thanks for the invite, buddy. We'll talk to you guys soon. Have a good one.
Always, Mac. Thanks a lot. I got a couple super chats here, and then we're going to get into the Helldivers 2 and the servers issue. I do want to talk about that. Ocelot says...
Yes. Yo, if you don't mind, man, I don't know if you want to get the chats, so maybe get the chats.
I'm a little behind. Yeah, just give me two seconds.
Let's get your chats.
Ocelot says, Sony is Barry Bonds when press asks about steroids. Let me tell you something. I don't know what you mean by that, Ocelot, but I'll tell you right now, even if I took 2 years of steroids, I wouldn't be able to hit 10 home runs, okay? So it's still a talent to be able to hit home runs. I don't care. So I'm not sure what Ocelot meant by that. Babor, like I said, is very angry tonight. I've never seen Babor this upset. He says we are getting effed by PlayStation, and he's a huge PlayStation guy. He says Helldiver server issues are unacceptable. I pay for online. These effing need a massive failure or a hack from PC gamers. All right, Babor, I don't think it's any of that, but I understand why you're frustrated. I do believe, hopefully, according to Arrowhead, we'll have a solution by the end of this week. Lord Metroid says, Nintendo, more games we didn't spend a dime on. Sphere, shout out to Sphere. He says, I still don't have to buy an Xbox One, play PlayStation 5 games. Babor's back. He says, Brap, I understand it. It irks me. Death of a console. PlayStation literally killing itself by reducing the reason to buy so that folks can justify GPU purchases. Babor, I've not seen you this angry in a while. Shout out to Game Knobs. He says, Mooch, treat yourself to hi-fi on me. And he gives me a great super chat. Thank you, Game Knobs. And then Full Sweat Tryhard says, here's 20 to not play that trash, Mooch. Why try flush? Oh, you guys are hysterical. The great Full Sweat. Thank you. Tony Steele says, everyone that talks about the cloud, the future, but won't the internet companies raise the prices because they see people using more data? That's an interesting, that's
a whole that's another thing.
That's a whole other podcast.
Data cat.
Domino. That's another domino.
You know? Yeah,
supply and demand.
So, Jez, did you want to add something?
Dude, I got the Grindhouse rundown. I was listening to you guys. I was at put the kids to bed and all that other stuff.
Wait, Jez, you have a movie theater in your house.
Yeah, I do. The Grindhouse
Theater. I just saw that. I'm like, oh, shit.
The Grindhouse Theater.
I know. Yeah. I put it up. Yeah, I did. You do that projector. It's what do I have? It's it's an Optima gaming projector. It was like,
I was like, Jez, we need to talk.
Yo, yeah, it's incredible. It's my whole wall. I'm all about immersion, dude. That's why I have that screen. I got the headphones. I got the control. I'm like, just like, yeah, 4D basically. Be like, just rocking to have that thing on the wall. It's crazy. But yeah, it's awesome. That's my gaming setup. One of them there. But yeah, and I'll tell you, I think it's that Best Buy. The projector's like, I think it was like $1,300, $1,400. So it's not like no $5,000 freaking gaming projector, but it does do high free refresh rate.
Is it the one that does 4K?
Yeah, it does 4K, and it's a laser projector. So it doesn't need the lamps, and it lasts like just as long as your TV would do. And it's not as loud, it doesn't get as hot, and it gets very bright because it's a laser projector. Not a short throw, so you need to kind of have it behind you.
I got to add the, Jez, you got to send me the soundtrack to the, you know when they walk people off the stage for the Oscars? I have to play that. Brap wins the award for derailing a podcast as best.
Hey, hey. I'll get you onto that. So the rundown things, I will tell you, first I wanted to... So that whole migration thing when you guys talking about bringing people to PC and stuff, one thing I wanted just to add to that was that, you know, Microsoft didn't just, when they put their venture to PC, they didn't just put their games on PC. They wanted to move people to PC. They made you, when you bought your game, you get the game in the Windows 10 store as well. They brought your whole chat to chat for free. All your gamers and stuff on the PC. They brought over the game bar. They basically brought over the console to the PC. So they kind of technically migrated the whole ecosystem, brought achievements, all that stuff over there. You know, Sony is not as aggressive as that now. Maybe they do later on. But right now, they're just putting a game. It's a trickle down, that waterfall method, where it's like, hey, just like you see movies in the movie theater, they trickle down and they put them on Netflix, broader audience, you know? And they kind of get that premium price up front, get the best experience, optimized, you know, development, and then put it down where it wants to be and meet the expectations at each of the levels of the waterfall. So that's what they're doing right now. Now, there are some games, like the multiplayer ones, that they can put on multiple platforms, and it makes sense because you want that big audience on day one. But it's the commitment of everything that Microsoft did where they just try to make round pegs into square holes and realize that maybe for some games it didn't work for them. You know, maybe games would have been better being prioritized on the console first and then go to PC. But Microsoft didn't have that position. They kind of went all in Game Pass, just like they did with Kinect. They said, oh, nobody's going to believe. We got to throw Kinect in the box and charge them $500. And that's not what people wanted. And then they did the same thing with Game Pass. They said, we got to go all in. Everything we ever make, ever will do, ever will buy, ever will see, goes in this service. And it was just this definitive kind of everything and not... should have been everything. And, you know, and we've seen that. And my biggest problem with the whole day and date stuff is that I don't want to see my games diluted and hear excuses why things that we would expect on day one when you're charging me $70 are not there because you had to configure for billions of PC configurations to get it out for day one and, you know, didn't optimize it for the place I want to play. You know, Phil says, play where you want to play. And it's like, yeah, that'll be great if the game is great everywhere. But if it's missing things because it's everywhere, then maybe I'm not going to buy it right now. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that was my thing just with the migration stuff. And the other thing I wanted to vent on is the PlayStation VR2. Yes. I've expressed these on my channel as well. I'm disappointed in Sony's support for the VR2. Not to say that there's no games for it, but where are their games for it? And that's the thing that I had a problem with PSVR2, especially that they stopped talking about it. And even at the end of last year, when the guy was like, and I don't know what suit or business guy said was going, oh, you know, it we just put it out there, and, you know, it like nothing to kind of reinvigorate it. I thought they were gonna have like a second launch or something like that at the end of the year.
Yeah,
they just kind of basically just So yeah, it's out there if you want it. And I want their games for it. And I think it's good that they're doing the PC support, because there's tons of games on PC and tons of different use cases for these things, like in big screen. And, you know, I've used that with the Meta, like big screen, yep. Just kind of watching like sports games with a, you know, in a theater with like guys throwing like popcorn at the screen. Like, it's such a cool, like bar like experience in your house.
What I think, and, though, Jez, yeah. tell me what you think about this, though. I think the problem with the PSVR 2 as well is we've crossed over, right? Look what's hot right now, okay? And I know, guys, hold your opinions on Apple's and that, but the Apple Vision Pro, which is, you know, $3,500, but, and the Meta Quest 3, they're really utilizing the VR and the AR space.
Yeah.
And that's the thing. So, you know, Sony probably wasn't thinking about this at the time. They're like, well, listen, if you're a console gamer only, this is the only real device for you, unless you're going to go and buy a Meta Quest 2 at the time. But the Meta Quest 3 came out and really wowed them because they have that AR functionality, right? And you have that. That was the one thing that you were saying about that game.
It's really cool. And they have games that utilize it. But just the fact of it, I feel like there's a lot of opportunities that Sony could have used to embrace their platform. Like, even, I would say, develop something like a virtual reality home space to like market your product, your games, to kind of make us launch our games in VR in some sort of virtual space, play ping pong, like just have fun in some sort of like use cases for VR. Like, and you could even tie that into your PlayStation Plus subscription. Like, you're in that PlayStation Plus subscription, you get added, you know, to this kind of community thing and do other things with the VR. And I just wanted to see more support from them. Like, when they launched it, I was like, oh, they got Horizon. They did it with the VR 2. They added a lot of their games had VR modes. They didn't have anything for Spider-Man. They had nothing for the holiday for VR from them. They got a lot of meta games ported over to it. And then now the PC support, which is great. But, like, does that mean, it's kind of confusing, because it's like, does that mean that they're going to be PlayStation VR games going? Mm. So, like, you know, is Horizon VR game going to be on PC? Is it for Steam VR? Is it going to use all the features of the headset with the eye tracking and all those other things?
It's very vague. Or, yeah.
Or is it going to be just the
PlayStation? You guys know why it's going to PC, right?
What do you got, B?
Why?
Because Gran Turismo is going to PC.
There you go.
And Flight Simulator, they could play now with it.
Well, yeah,
we could try to put VR on Flight Simulator.
So wait, it's GT7 is dictating that, B?
Yeah, GT7 is moving to PC. PlayStation for a long time has been trying to get GT to be on PC. They're losing a lot of you know, hardcore racing fans to iRacing.
Mm-hmm.
And they don't want to miss out on that space, so they're going to put GT on PC.
That makes sense.
That makes perfect sense. I was talking to Xbox One earlier today, and he was saying the same thing. He goes, "I've been waiting for this. This is a reason for me to do it, because I can play now. I can play GT7, which, by the way, that is an amazing experience.
On PC, it'll be great too.
Shout out to Eric, who sent this post on Twitter to me and you, Jez. The CEO of Arrowhead and creative director of Helldivers 2, he just tweeted this out. I believe it was at 8:21 p.m. Eastern time. He says, my communication skills at 2 a.m. has gone downhill. I deleted several tweets to avoid misinformation confusion. He says, the server cap, max CCUs, has been raised. We might still hit the limit in the future, but for right now, we are above what we have been able to support. We are actively monitoring the situation. With that, good night, and sorry for my late night rambling. So we were just talking about the servers with Helldivers. Let's get into that a little bit. Eric, I don't know how much Helldivers you've been playing, what you think, but I know that you're well aware of the situation. It is an overnight phenomenon. It's breaking records in certain aspects on Steam, and we don't have the PlayStation numbers yet, but I would assume that they're still going to be quite impressive for bogging down the system the way that it has been. But here you are, you're hearing that now they may have started to fix the problem and maybe get ahead of it a bit. This is a smaller team. I don't know what the exact number is. Maybe B knows. But Eric, what do you think of the whole situation, from the success of Helldivers 2 to the complications of playing the game?
excuse me. I think it's one of those things where, you know, even like publishers like a Sony or whatever, who've been in the game for a long time, may not always know what they have. And it's kind of interesting when you see what they promote and the reason they may promote something versus something else. Because I know a lot of people were wondering and saying, well, Helldivers 2 is dropping and it's a multiplayer game, you know, multiplayer focused game, but they've done no betas, they've done no previews, they've done like nothing. And I honestly think that's probably where they kind of tripped. You know, they probably should have tried to do some of those things. And it's interesting, you know, that they didn't really put a whole lot of focus on that, but they put more focus on something like a Foam Stars. So that's why I'm kind of wondering with that, is that more like contractual obligation that they had to put that more front and center and not really kind of put that focus on Helldivers? But I'm sure now they're kind of looking at, well, damn, you know? And it seems obviously Arrowhead wasn't necessarily prepared coming off of what was like a Vita title before, you know, with like a cult following.
Right.
And probably wondering, you know, hey, is this going to hit or not? But it's just that thing where it's like when someone's like playing through something, you're doing, you know, you're doing play testing and you're, you know, internally previewing, it's like, are you that close to it where you don't really know what you have? Or again, that's why you need to kind of maybe expand it a little bit and get some buzz going, get some talks going. And maybe that may alleviate some of these situations, because it's just, it is kind of wild that every time they open the server up, it just gets, you know, packed again to capacity. Well, like I've only been able to play it for a few hours. Shout out to Slow-Mo and Ramon and Forte, like last week.
Yep.
Before, like, you know, the President's Day weekend hit and all hell broke loose.
The thing about it, though, yeah. Eric, too, is that I felt that, remember, every single day for the past 6 days, it kept on breaking concurrent numbers and this and that. So it's almost like they went to the drawing board, fixed things, and they were like, we have a server that can handle the 400, you know, the 300,000. And then the next day they went to 400,000. You know what I mean? So it was almost like they're just catching up. And I'm thinking now, we haven't really heard about them going over the 500,000 concurrent. So maybe things are starting to taper off a little bit and now they're able to catch up. That's still yet to be seen. You know, and I hate to go back. I usually, when we go to a subject, I don't usually go back. But, you know, X-Hawk says here, and I do want to quote him here. He says, this news, and he's referring to PSVR 2. And Jack, what do you think when you hear this? He says, this news tells me that PSVR 2 flopped. The reason I don't think it flopped was, I think it's more along the lines of what I was telling Jez, is that, you know, AR, the AR-VR space mixed reality has kind of taken the world by storm. People are walking around, they're going to get McDonald's with their Apple Vision Pros on, they're having conversations, they're in the mall, there's people driving. I know some of that's set up, but my point being is, Jack, is this a situation, there's over 200 games to play for the PSVR 2. I understand, we can make our case that Sony dropped the ball on first party, but you can't say you went and bought the device and there's nothing to play. There's some amazing
games. No, there's games on that. No, so, that's a big thing. No, there's games, well, yeah.
Jack, do you think this is a case of it flopping, or do you think this is a case of Sony going, wait a minute, we need more customers, because at this point, mixed reality is taking over the space. It's not a VR set anymore where you put the headset on and you're just gone from the world. People like that immersion of having real life integrated with their games. That's what's happening now. What do you think, Jack? Is PSVR 2 a flop? That's why they're doing it? I don't know if that's necessarily the case, but it might be.
Excuse me. I feel like, I do feel like it's flopping. I do. Okay. If you look at it in comparison, especially in comparison to the other VR headsets on the market, it's getting trounced right now, right? Mm-hmm. Even with the 200 games, I just feel like optically, right? And this is from the outside looking in, because like I said, I was going to get one, but the more I heard about it, the more I didn't want one, right? On the outside looking in, especially from like Jez was saying, from a first party output, it's terrible, right? They had the Horizon, but other than that, you know, like I said, they had the Firewall game, but apparently that game launched broken.
And Jack, and you know, the other thing is that the Firewall didn't hit, and then the Shadow, what was that other one with that the horror game on the thing? That thing didn't have the foveated rendering. Like, a couple of their exclusive games didn't have some good launches. It got delayed again. So, like, the most polished one was Horizon when it launched, but the other two games, I forget what it was, the Shadow, I forgot what it was called. It was called the roller coaster one, horror roller coaster game.
Oh, you talking about
Blood,
the Until Dawn joint? That's what you're talking about?
Well, no, there's somebody in the chat will know it. I forgot what it's called. I think it starts with an S. It was the one that's the roller coaster horror game. It's made by the guys that made.
It's made by
Sledgehammer. Not Sledgehammer, Jesus. Sway. Yeah. No, that's Sledgehammer. Holy shit, I'm drawing a blank, dude.
I can see, I'm drinking too much tea. The picture's a woman's face, is the picture of the icon on your PlayStation. It's like a vampire woman or something. I don't know. I can't.
No. Switchback. Thank you, Brian East. Holy crap.
Switchback. Yes.
That is Switchback. That was supposed to be the pot from the
that
other game.
That one?
It was, yeah, the people that made Until Dawn. Yeah, the people that make those horror games. Yeah, and they made The Impatient on PSVR.
Yep. Russia Blood, they made Russia Blood.
Russia Blood. So that Switchback was the sequel to Russia Blood, but it came out and it didn't have good, like, the it wasn't clear. It was very blurry, and they waited for patching over a month or so. And that was mess. And then Firewall, that one had issues. And then that studio, I think, went down.
Yeah, that dev shut down.
Yeah.
And this is going back to something B-Money said. And this is another problem I really have with Sony right now. They're getting to a point where they're trying to be the jack of all trades, the masters of none. They're clearly spread too thin. They hopping off the porch on way too much stuff for no reason, bro. Movies, TV, games going here, games going there.
Accessories, dude.
Accessories. Here's a accessories, a portal, a headset. New
PlayStation
revision. Like VR. Like, bro, you have to hone in on some of this stuff, man. The support for VR2 alone has been abysmal. Mm-hmm. Just optically. Like, they're showing it no love. There's no word on. Today was the first news we heard about it, and it was about it going to another platform. It wasn't about, you know what I mean? It wasn't like we was just getting... At the end, they announced some new games for PSVR2, but it ain't like, you know, they just showing love to the platform like that. So yep. I definitely think it's flop, and I think they go on the PC as a last-ditch effort. Like I said, I think it should always launch on PC, because, I mean, if you go on the PC, like, I don't like the toe-dipping stuff either, man. Either you're going to go the half-measure stuff, I'm not really with that. Yeah. Either you're going to do it or you're not going to do it. You're going to get off the pot, right? So,
yeah,
it should have been on PC.
I think it's for Steam VR. I think, like, you know, the fact that there's tons, if they do Steam VR and Oculus, like, they support the PC platforms on there, that there was a big... a push, because that is really the cheapest headset for the best technology. That's why people want it. They want the tech and then put it on PC. I think there's going to be some exciting things with the tech that Sony probably could never do. And maybe they'll have some PC guys like do some crazy things, and maybe they'll bring it back to, like, you know, some things into their games or something like that. But I think they're really going to, you know, really utilize the power of this thing, which I feel that Sony should have, you know, really try to have pushing for the first year. Plus, too, they didn't really even put it on sale during the holidays. Like, no bundles. Like, I don't know if they're trying to prep this thing.
They're not selling it.
Well, then drop the price. Like, lower the price then.
Yeah, but they're taking a loss on it. So then what's the point?
I don't know then. I don't know, but maybe they're tying they're pro. Maybe they're going to do like what they did with the previous generation, where the VR benefited from the pro, and maybe they'll try to bundle it with that, like relaunch it with that. I don't know.
Yeah,
they kind of put it out there.
Yeah, I'm sure the pro will, you know,
I don't know, dude, some
benefits for it. But I think, you know, kind of like Jack, I think it's flopping. I think.
Yeah, I don't think it's selling that much.
I think they needed to release it sooner. I think they expected the PS5 to be out sooner.
Yeah,
and I think they waited too long, and I think the fad for VR is kind of over with.
Yep. It's going more to that. They're not going to
really sell many more pieces of hardware in that space. And I wouldn't expect them to, like, if they don't see like a huge bump going into the second half of the PS5 generation, I wouldn't expect them to do PSVR 3.
Yeah.
And AR stuff, that is another level of gaming too. Like, that I really is such a cool thing, having overlays and things like that for the AR.
I think if they really cool. No, Jez, I think what you said and what B just kind of alluded to, this is what I was getting at. The AR, you know, the mixed reality has taken over. You can wear a Quest, a Meta Quest 3, you could play a VR game, but then you can also play a game, or you can also hit a button and you can also see what's going on in front of you. You know, maybe not to the extent of the Apple Vision Pro, but that's important. The other thing is, I think Jack was saying, is just so many. There's like, I mean, don't get me wrong. As a consumer, as a gamer, I mean, it is exciting in a sense. I like the Portal, the VR. I played a lot of GT7 with it. I really did. I played a lot of the Switchback. By the way, I sent you the picture, Jez. It is that lady's head. That's the picture that's on all of our PlayStations. So I played a lot of that. I played these games I liked. I played Horizon Call of the Mountain. Like, the thing about it, though, is that not when you are completely immersed into that headset, You can't hear anything. You can't see anything. You're gone. Like, you're gone. And I know this sounds crazy, but I do think the VR world is leaving. And I think that the mixed reality AR, VR is going to come in full swing. So, B, if they do a VR, it won't be a VR. It'll be a mixed headset if they do one in next generation. That's a big if, by the way. That's a big if.
They may do a redesign to this one, Mooch. Like, they may have, like, because they did do it the first one. They did do a redesign where they made it just one single cable, not all that box and stuff. So, who knows? The way they're pumping out hardware.
They've done AR before, if you remember on the Vita. And the Vita actually had some AR.
There is some AR with this when you set up the room. Like, there is overlays and stuff like that, but they use black and white lenses similar to the Quest 2. So if they do come out with a revision, because they did do this with the first one, you got to go by history. Like, they did come out with a revision to the VR. Mm-hmm. Maybe they're going to drop the price of this one, come out with a VR 2 version 2. That one has colored pass-through lenses. PC support, it's going to have console support, and maybe they'll stop putting in AR games and doing more stuff with it. I don't know. But the way they, like what Jack was saying, like the way they've been throwing out hardware, I wouldn't put it past them to say, yeah, here's a version two of it, you know?
Yeah, yep. No, I agree. I think the door is closing on VR, but opening on a mixed reality. I think that's what we may see.
It is really cool.
It is a neat thing. Brap, I'm going to go back to Helldivers 2 because I know that you've been having some issues, Brap, with getting in. And I know you'll say fortunately. I'll say unfortunately because the workaround that's worked in this past week, we'll find out after the show. I think I'm going to hop on and play a few matches. Is you what Jez was saying. You see your friends. You see the activity cards. You can jump right in. I've been doing that for the better part of a week. That does not mean that I haven't waited.
I was trying to join on you, Mooch, last night. You had a full room.
I did have a full squad. Dude, the minute I get in there solo, it don't take long for people on the friends list to just like,
I know.
Whoop, whoop, whoop. They just jump right in there.
It's awesome.
It is great. It's great to see the community alive and well. So many random people playing games. Like, this is fun, man. This is like, this reminds me of the old school,
yes,
like
it does.
Call of Duty days. So it is a blast to be gaming on this right now. But Brap, you're a big proponent of goodwill, and you like it when devs, you know, put the truth out there, and it's not always about nickel and dime you, right? So Brap, the Helldivers developer advised to hold off on buying the game while they fix the servers. This was a couple days ago. Now they're saying, hey, we've got a good hold on this as of right now. I'm not saying everything's future proof, but you know, go enjoy it. Brap, was that a good move? I've never really seen anybody say, hey, don't buy my product yet.
Well, I mean, I think at this point they've clearly have, you know, they have a hit on their hands, and this thing went above and beyond what they thought. So I mean, they're probably like, hey, we're rolling in the money right now. We can afford to make these kind of comments. But that aside, I mean, I think it was the right thing to say. I mean, Steam's not going to refund people. PlayStation's not going to give people refunds because of, you know, not being able to get into servers, unfortunately. So I was actually happy that they addressed it. So, hey, I mean, we talk about being pro-consumer. That's probably the most pro-consumer thing you can do outside of issuing a refund. So I was glad to hear that. But it's nice to hear. But for me, it's like, okay, that ship has sailed. I already paid the $40 for the game,
right?
And I still can't get in. I mean,
right?
Yeah, it's great for those people who haven't, you know, spent the $40, and we're thinking about jumping into the game.
Yeah.
Now they've been warned. Hey, don't buy it until we increase server capacity. But that's the one, and I'm actually surprised that it's been able to maintain player concurrent count as high as it has, because one of the concerns I had was, okay, are people going to start leaving, and is it going to start getting reviewed, like where we start seeing negative reviews on Steam, user reviews, because of the server issue? And I saw a little bit of that, where people were like, hey, guys, like, you need to fix this. This is really frustrating. I spent $40, you know, like, we appreciate the effort. You know, people are actually being mostly polite, but...
Mostly.
They got it. Yeah, mostly, right? But they got to figure this thing out. I mean, it's. I think if this is an ongoing issue, and it sounds like they've added some additional servers, if this is a thing that's going to continue, maybe it hurts the game in the future. Hopefully that's not the case, because when I have played the game, it's actually a lot of fun.
It is. You know, the one thing and that I was. You know, go ahead, Jess.
I was saying that's the point. Like, you know, I think, you know, the fact that the game is so, you know, there's little bugs and stuff like that. Of course, there's bugs, but But like, you know, there's some glitches and things like that, but primarily the it's seamless, like jumping in the mission, jumping down, doing what you got to do. The combat is so great and all the stuff going on in the screen. Like you don't get like it's no technical issues with the game, you know, besides your traditional, maybe a glitch here and there, but like, it's just the server capacity and try and get into it. And I could tell the frustration, you buy something and you can't access it. That is definitely a frustrating thing, but I feel that this game, the way it's designed, and it is, first off, it's a streamer's paradise because the emergent combat, the craziness that happens, the stories, and I was saying this on my stream, like, it gives you those water cool moments, like Mooch was saying, like back in the day where you would just come to work, but like, you believe what happened? I had this thing, and yeah. I dropped this grenade, and or yeah. they killed me, and I had this airstrike came. Like you have all these crazy stories, and it's just like for streamers and for just playing, it's just so much fun because you never know what's gonna happen next, and like it's fun when you play single player. Like I've done a couple of single player missions, and it's such a different dynamic of like trying to avoid combat and just getting the mission done than trying to call in airstrikes and blow up everything. That's like your last ditch effort. You play totally different than when you're playing with four people. Plus you could drop SOSs down, and when your back is against the wall, you see some Helldiver just jump down and just start shooting and helping you out. It's really, really incredible feeling. It's like, yes, I got somebody to help me, and then you stay grouped up with them. Like I think the way the game is designed, this thing is going to really, I think, have a lot of legs to it, especially the way they have the planets getting liberated, and each planet gives you a whole new set of environments and atmospheric effects. They even added some of them give you special orbital, like they want you to use other types of orbital strikes and stuff. Yep. So one gives you EMPs. So the variety in the mission structures and the, you know, the procedural generated maps, and the way that we're all competing, doing our part to liberate planets, to get a new planet, to find out what new environments and new things that we're going to see. So we're all like progressing together in the campaign. And it looks great too. And the explosions are the incredible thing. It's very cinematic. It's the welcoming
gameplay though that really has it. And I'll give you guys an example. I already kind of mentioned it, so I won't go into too much detail. But you guys know I'm a big fan of The Last of Us. I have told my friends that I play a lot of the Warzone games, all the multiplayer with them. I tell them about. They're like, "Wow, that sounds great. The Last of Us sounds great." You know how many times? You know how many of them bought The Last of Us? None of them. This game here already has that effect on a lot of people. I'll say the masses. It's a very easy pick up and play type of game. It is a streamer's paradise. You're right, Jez. It definitely is a fun thing to do. It definitely keeps an audience engaged because of the friendly fire, the environment, the explosions.
Friendly fire, dude.
It just doesn't get old, right? And the only thing I think that they need to do to ensure it doesn't get old is, like, I think some of the tasks on the planet, they need to start adding some more when they get a chance. Some new ones, yes. That needs to happen more sooner than later. That was one of the things I saw early on in reviews before the game came out for the public, is they said, I could not put the controller down. I had so much fun, but I could see maybe after a month and a half, this game would start to get repetitive if they don't add more mission types and enemy types, et cetera, et cetera. So I do agree with all of that there. But I think the game has legs. I think that it may be one of those games that eventually is it going to take the place? Can this be people have been saying this to me. That's why I'm bringing it up, but I'm hesitating because it's a wild stretch. Could this be like where Fortnite came out, and Fortnite was not Fortnite when it first came out? Remember, it was four player, and it was, it was kind of like, it was almost like, how do you describe the first defense?
Yeah.
That defense game?
I know. Yeah. I'll answer
tower
first.
Tower defense.
Thank you. Tower defense.
Yeah, exactly. That's what it was. Yeah.
Is this a game that can start to break off and make different modes and become bigger than it already is, or no?
Well, they added Battle Royale, the free part to it.
Right. But would they do something similar where they make this, or it doesn't need that? They just need to keep adding planets and keep adding tasks. That's enough.
Yeah, I don't think this has, not Fortnite stuff. Fortnite is like now, like pop culture. Like, I think this has a good, like, good staying power, like maybe like Apex Legends or something like that, like kind of staying as like a go-to multiplayer game. Mm-hmm. But again, it has to do, you're right, with the mission structure and keeping it fresh. I know there's a third enemy faction from what people said in the first game, and you know, they could add that as well, and mission types, you know, they seem to be pretty, you know, randomly generated, but they definitely need some more. I've escorted, but I'd use that nuke, even though that nuke mission never gets old, though. Watching that explosion.
It doesn't get old. It's
with this being technically a first party game, what they should do is add enemy types from different PlayStation games.
Yes. Add them from Resistance.
Yeah, Resistance. They got them from
Chimera.
Yeah, they got them.
That would be awesome. Armor set.
Yeah, they can add a lot of stuff that just comes directly from PlayStation. And then just other PlayStation properties. Like, they could add stuff from Starship Troopers. That's absolutely what the game is basically based on anyway.
That's right. Mm-hmm. 100% agree. Now, B, I always like to ask you these questions. Your predictions, I think you're like Nostradamus, dude. You call it, and it's awesome, dude. Is Arrowhead going to be a PlayStation studio, or is that just, is it wishful thinking?
I think they will be. I don't know if it'll happen anytime soon, like as far as like the next month or something like that. But I could see it happening by the end of the year. I think them and Ballistic Moon both are probably like the top of the list right now, because I don't think they're gonna go for like these big, you know, major purchases. Mm-hmm. I think they're just gonna continue adding, you know, smaller studios, just, you know, another cog in the wheel that can, you know, produce high quality content. You know, that's really what they're looking for. So yeah. I wouldn't be surprised if by the end of the year, Arrowhead is, you know, we see that splash screen of them being added to the family.
Yeah, I'm right there with you. I don't think it'll happen overnight, but it definitely could happen. I think even what you said, end of the year, B, sounds a little aggressive. I think it could even bleed a little bit into next, but I do honestly think that that's the case. I this is a partnership here, and if this does have legs, it's something that Sony's going to want to be married to. I don't think it's something that they're going to want to just have that third, you know, that. How do you want to put it? Just that it was a second party deal with them, or however you want to kind of put it. They own the IP, but they would have to constantly be in works with Arrowhead. So, and they're a small enough group.
They don't want Tencent or like somebody to come buy, you know, a huge portion of the company, and, you know, then it makes it more difficult to make the purchase. So I think if anything, it happens probably sooner rather than later.
Okay. Because, you know, that's a good point. Yeah,
you see, you know, something successful, then of course it puts them on the radar of everybody else who's willing to throw money at them. So, you know, you kind of got to be wary of that too.
That's a very good point. So I want to ask, just to kind of come off Helldivers, and if anyone has anything to add, they certainly can. We can always go back. But Jack, you were saying that you've kind of had it with, like, you got VR, you got headsets, you got portals, you got PS5, you got PS5 Slim, you got PS5 Pro. It just goes on and on. So, Jack, and I know the reason I'm saving me and Jez, I was talking to Jez last night. I didn't pick up the first ones, Jack, but I did pick up the Pulse Elite headset. And I'm not going to lie, the main reason is I wanted to have that link so I could play the Portal without using a wired headset. But for $149, I have my opinions. I'll save it. Jack, is this a headset you would pick up, or there's not enough, you know, in the box to really motivate you?
Honestly, the only reason I would pick it up is the same reason to play the Portal would, but I don't really have a reason to pick them up, to be honest. I like Sony headsets, man. The only thing I don't like about Sony headsets, the mics on them are always trash. It'll have good audio quality, but I'm kind of like a stickler for like the mic. Like,
yes,
I be wanting to at least be like decent, but and then that price point, it ain't that crazy for a headset, you know what I mean? But I'm cheap at the same time, so it's crazy to me. Yeah, I wouldn't personally. Not so, right now. Maybe the earbuds they got, but them earbuds like what, $200?
The earbuds.
Don't buy the earbuds.
Yeah, I returned them too, Jack. I didn't like
them. Yeah, those earbuds are not good.
Yeah, I didn't like them.
Okay.
And they're $200.
They cost more. That's crazy.
So you know what's crazy to me is Jack made a good Jack, thanks for setting this up, dude, because you said what I was saying to Jez yesterday. So the headset feels good, it's ridiculously comfortable. The $149 price point is spot on. They did a good thing and not such a good thing with the microphone. So, Jack, here's what they did right. And Jez, you can contradict me if you think I'm wrong. What they did right was, when I'm talking, Jack, you on the other side will hear nothing but clarity. You won't hear me eating. You won't hear me breathing heavy. You won't hear none of that. It's nice and clean for the recipient of the noise. The problem is the mic monitoring. That's a very big deal for me. I do it in podcasting. I do it when I have my Astros on. Like, I like when I talk, this is not, I like to be able to hear so I'm not screaming over
yeah,
the noise in my headset.
I think it's a New York problem. I have the same problem.
It's a problem. Like,
I think it's just us.
I was East gaming Coast. Last night.
You like to feel like how loud you talking.
Because I'm always getting yelled at. I'm shouting.
Yeah, I'm loud. You know, I'm loud. Not that you guys are surprised. But my point being, right, is so I asked Jez. I said, Jez, do they have the mic monitoring this? Because he took the whole thing apart. He did an unboxing. And I know him. He's already five manuals deep. Me, I'm just like, let's put this thing on. Let's play some games. So I go to put, I could not find the mic monitoring. Then Jez finally shows me where it's available, Jack. And again, it's just not done right. So yes, they had it on there. I maxed out mic monitoring. And at the same time, it's a whisper. I'm talking at a high volume into the headset and I can barely hear myself. So it's not a real one-to-one how you sound. So again, you're right. Every single PlayStation headset, and even the Steel Series, which is not even a Sony product.
Steel Series are good ones, yeah.
They have a bad microphone. I don't like that. I don't mind the headset, but I don't like the microphone.
Yeah.
I don't know. That's my take.
I've tested every single headphone. I could tell you exactly which ones to use for microphones. I've used every single one. So the I kept the ones I like. So I'll tell you, the microphone on this, you're right. The mic monitoring, which is buried, and if you need to know where it is, it's under accessories, under headset, and then it's at the bottom where it says side tone, and you got to increase that. And it does sound very kind of robotic, and I think it has to do with the AI voice cancellation that makes you where you can eat a bag of chips and nobody hears it. It doesn't pick up a lot, any ambient noise. Like if you have anything going on, it won't pick it up. Like it has a very clean microphone. I think it's the better microphone. It's better than the H9s, which that had a very hissy microphone. I did not like that one. It picked up a lot. Those were more comfortable though, the H9s, because they're more akin to the Sony's, you know, main headphones, the WM5s. But these Pulse Elites are very comfortable. The sound is great. These are the first time that they have the planar drivers in them in the big headsets. They do have them in the Pulse, the little ones.
The sound is very good.
Yeah, the sound is very clear. It emphasizes a lot of the highs and the mids, and you hear a lot of different elements that you would miss with the traditional drivers that we have in every other headset, where it's more rumbly and muddy. This one, you hear a lot of clarity and a lot of directional. It's incredible with the direction that I basically packed up my Razer Blackhawk V2s and sent them back, and I'm like, I'm keeping these. But I'll tell you one thing, the Razer Blackhawk V2s have a good microphone. The best microphone, if you want one, it's the Corsair HS80. They have almost a broadcasting microphone.
That's what I get, yeah. Those,
yeah, they sound great. Those are the best ones. Those are the best ones for the microphone. And you see, Jack is right. He loves microphones. That's the best one. I tested them all out. The Steel Series does not have a great microphone. The high-end Turtle Beach one had a good one. But that one had a pretty good microphone too, but I found that the HS80, the Corsairs, were all the best ones for a microphone. The Razors were pretty good too. I broadcasted with those, but these, I'm going to broadcast with these. The only thing I recommend too is that keep it a little bit away from your mouth. If you put it too close to your mouth, you can get a lot of, it doesn't have a pop filter, so you're going to get a lot of the hissy and the S's and the P's might be a little harsh. So keep it a little bit away from your mouth, but I got to tell you, it has simultaneous Bluetooth as well, so you can listen to Mooch's show or my show or anybody's show, Jack Mooch's show, anybody's show on here, and while you're playing games. So you could do simultaneous Bluetooth and gaming at the same time.
Yes.
I won't recommend these for listening to music. If you have very thumpy music or listen to dance music, with these as a Bluetooth headset, the planar drivers aren't it. They do get kind of, they break up a little bit at the bottom, so they're not that clean bass that you would get if you want to listen to some like music with them and use them in that instance. But for games, they're awesome. I used them 3 hours last night. I played on Helldivers. And Helldivers, you know, it's almost incredible how they have this game with this incredible audio and explosions and immersion, and then those headsets came out. It's like the perfect accessory for this game. And for the price, for what you're getting, $150 in the world of $200 headphones and $350 headphones for gaming.
That's it.
These are a great price for $150. So, and I would recommend these over the original Pulses because they have a better microphone on these.
And they have the better sound. And they have the better ear, what is it?
Ear cushions.
The ear cushion material. So, you know, the thing about it is, I do want to reiterate. So if you're doing a valid review, dollar comes in the place here. Because I've talked to a lot of people, they're like, well, Mooch, I really like my H9s. I tried the H9s. They were okay, but just like Jack said, the H9s, for me, the microphone was...
The microphone's not good. Horrible. I didn't like the microphone, yeah.
Horrible. So I'm like, well, the H9s are also double the price. So
yeah.
These here have that planar... What is it called there? The planar effects or whatever that technology is. It has the link technology in there.
Yes, that's again, it.
If you do care about who you're gaming with, the people that you game with will love that you bought this headset. They will love you. You are going to sound good, and you will have no distortion in your voice, and you won't hear anything in the background. So your friends are going to love that you bought it. I think that if you're used to hearing yourself talk through your headset, or you like to be able to at least gauge your own voice, you'll find that to be a little bit challenging. There is that area Jez said you can go do, but it's not great. It's better than if you don't do it, but it's not great. Mm-hmm. But again, I got to say, if you're in the market for a headset and you don't want to go spend $200-$400 for $150, this does a lot for you in the PlayStation ecosystem. Again, because you could play the Portal, you could play your PS5. Heck, I could just use the dongle and plug it into the PC. I can use it. It's good for PC gaming, and it does have Bluetooth. That's the other thing, Jez. You said that, so you can pair it to your phone.
Yeah, simultaneous Bluetooth, because the Razer has Bluetooth, but it only is for calls. You can't do simultaneous listen to music or listen to regular audio and play. Yeah.
You know, and if you are a PSVR2 owner, I saw a couple people doing reviews with that. It fits nicely over because it has that elastic band. So it does fit very nice over.
And it has a 3.5 millimeter head. It can be used wired as well. So the PSVR2, you can plug it in wired as well. So you don't have to use all the dongles set up there. So it doesn't come with the cable, though, the 3.5 cable.
No, it does
not. But it uses a regular cable.
But I don't even know why you would do that. It has a 30-hour battery.
I know, the battery's long.
That's amazing, too. So, again...
I haven't charged it yet. I'm leaving it to see.
It's been a very long time since I've legitimately said, yeah, you should go grab that. But I do... I think if you're in the market, I don't know. It's a pretty good deal for $149. If it was $200... And Jack had mentioned the earbuds. You guys know I was talking earbuds nonstop on Twitter. It was uncomfortable. They disconnected from my Xbox. Or, pardon me, from the PlayStation. I legit returned them in a week. I tried them out. They just didn't sit well with me at all. And I was disappointed. And they're $50 more than this headset. So, I don't know.
Yeah.
A lot of mistakes.
And I tried also, too. I tried the Link Buds. The Link Buds, which I think are better. If you're going to want headphones, what do they call their things? The H9s, but then there's the in-zone Buds. Those are $200. Those are better Sony Buds than the Portal ones. The difference is, though, is it doesn't have that new PlayStation Link, so you can't use them wirelessly with the Portal.
Right.
And the other thing I'm thinking, too, is that maybe the new PlayStation, the Pro, comes out, it has the Link built into it so that these new headsets will just go right to the PlayStation and you won't need any dongles on it. So maybe that might be a future in the PlayStation 5 Pro that they have these Links in them.
Yeah, Jack, did you have a question or B? I thought somebody was chiming in.
No.
No, I mean, I don't know. So the poll here, I did a real...
Oh, it also comes with a hook. I'm sorry, Mooch. It also comes with the hook thing to charge it while just by hanging. So you plug these headphones come with a hook that actually has a charger on it. So you could just plug that hook into USB. They don't give you the screw to mount onto a wall, but... You could just, you screw it into the wall, and then you have a plug that plugs the USB, and then you could just hang the headset on this hook, and it'll charge on the hook while, like, as wirelessly as you can, and you could just pull them off the hook, and they're charged.
Yeah, that is a nice, that's a nice option, but you have to have a place for that hook. That's the thing.
Yeah.
Like, I
know, I put a sticker on the back of it, and I stuck it to my entertainment center, and I just now hook it on there. We'll see how long
it
stays.
So you're not running a cord to it then? You're just using it as literally...
Yeah, I am. I'm running the cord from the PlayStation. Because I have a PlayStation on an entertainment center. I have the PlayStation. Oh, and that's another thing. Just let everybody know. When you get these, you got to update both the dongle and the PlayStation. I know me and Mooch were talking about this last night.
That's right.
You got to use both USBs. So you got to use a USB in the front for the dongle and then a USB in the back for the headset plugged in to update both of them at the same time. Yeah, dude. I was like, what?
That's ridiculous, bro.
That is ridiculous.
It was crazy.
I was like, is there another USB on the back? Because I only had the one on the front. And, yeah, you the have other to use one that, in the back.
No, the other part time. That's crazy about it too, Jack, is it takes a minute too. It's like,
and it takes a while.
You know, when you update your controller, you buy a new controller. It's like, we're gonna update your controller. You're like, all right, go ahead. and the line just kind of slides across from left to right. I thought that was going to happen here, so I hooked it up.
I know, Mooch is like, it takes a long time, Jez, right? I'm like, yeah, it does. I mean, it does take a while.
Well, I asked you
because it does have EQ settings too. Like, you can do EQ bass mode and all that stuff there. And it does do, if you triple tap the button, you could actually, it pulls right up the headphone EQ thing, right overlaying your game too. It does do that.
Yeah, shout out to Thumbs. He says, my work week is over. I'm smoking and playing Helldivers, calling in stratagems while high gets tricky. Thumbs, thank you. I appreciate that super chat, buddy. We're all jealous of you there. I was going to get into a few things here. Is anybody a big Elden Ring fan on the panel?
I never played it.
I'll be honest with you. So I was actually
Mooch, I played that one time with you during your stream, and I think it was the last time I played it.
Yeah, so I was thinking about streaming it through again. That's just something to have, like, so you can always kind of pick away at it until we get to the DLC. I might still do that. I thought that was a pretty cool thing. But I do want to say thanks to everybody that's here, guys. It's well over 9 o'clock here in New York. Great chat tonight. Outstanding chat. Thank you guys for the super chats. William Riggs, I also appreciate the subscription. I see all you guys out there. Babor Country comes back. Hopefully Babor's a little happier. He says, PlayStation Plus players should be a priority for Helldivers. PS Plus players. You know,
paying customers.
You know, they, yep. Yeah. You know, absolutely. But I don't know if he means, he may be referring, Jez, to saying, you know, PS Plus should get that game. I don't know if it should be. I mean, at this.
No,
at this,
I think he means priority with the servers. Let the PlayStation, let the PC guys wait, maybe.
I don't know how that's going to fly.
but let me ask you, talking about just that server thing.
Yeah.
I know we're going to wrap it up, but do you think that Sony looks at those numbers like on Steam and they're like, that could have been like PlayStation Plus subscribers, like paying for to play online. And now, you know, they look at that number and they're like 400,000 people playing. Maybe they think like it'll be zero, but they must think like, oh, we could have had some of those people probably paying for our subscription service to play. On our thing.
You're thinking from the PC element?
Yeah, like, I'm sure Sony looks at those numbers and maybe, like, you know, oh, yeah, well, that's nice that it's there, but maybe, man, some of those people might have been, like, PlayStation Plus subscribers that we could have got out of this thing. Like, if it took off the way it did, you know, it would have been only on PlayStation. Think about how that would have increased a lot of their subscriptions that they want so bad, having this game online. But the fact that you have, like, you know, not having a subscription, not needing to pay to play online, you know, and giving Steam 30%. Like, that's what I mean. Like, this whole going to other platforms, like you said, like, there's, like, it's going to increase their port. They got to port it over, but also everybody then gets a piece of their pie. Like, you know, by them keeping it in their storefront and they get all that back to them and have to just pay the devs. But when they start putting it on Steam, putting it over here, put Epic Store, like, they're all giving people a piece. Like, they're not getting all of it back.
B might even be able to answer this. So the one thing that I've heard rumors of is when they do start to do more involvement with PC, they're going to have their own Sony PlayStation Store, right? So where the
PC guys won't like that.
Well, no, they won't. No, they definitely
they're not going there.
No, they definitely won't like that. But I don't know if you're going to see them go immediately to Steam. They may go to the PlayStation storefront on PC and PlayStation, and then go.
They
to
might
Steam
go. They might go to Epic. I mean, they right. Be able to Epic already.
That's right.
Yeah, nobody likes right. Epic Store though.
Exactly. That's what I'm saying.
Well,
look at what people do, dude. Imagine having a PC, a game that you want to play goes on a different storefront, but you will not buy it because that storefront is ass.
See, that's mental illness right there. That's what I call it.
That is. I agree. But, you know, but Epic Store is ass, though. I have to say.
I think that's why they're going to keep their games on Steam. Like, they'll probably have a separate PC launcher, but I think they're always going to release their games on Steam. It's just like
maybe, you know, a publisher page Xbox or something like that, like a publisher page in Steam.
No, they already got
that. Yeah, they do.
They already got that.
Maybe some of them. Oh, yeah, they already have it, so.
Yeah, they have
I just can't see them open up a storefront because we've seen Microsoft actually shoves the storefront in your face. It's installed in the operating system, and still they couldn't get people to go there. I just don't know how. And even EA had their own storefront, and they just migrated all their stuff into Steam. Like, I don't think a new storefront is the answer for them to try to get, you know, unless they really build up a portfolio and they kind of do what Epic did and just, like, go off the tails of a popular game, like how Epic just started that store because of Fortnite. That store would not exist without Fortnite or Rocket League.
Yeah. No, that's true. It's funny because you brought up Epic and I don't remember, Jack, I think you said it. They have a deal already in place with them. I mean, like, that's That's possible, but I think the money to be made would be on Steam. They wouldn't probably venture away from that. I just thought maybe if they had their own launcher, that would be something, and that's where they would. That's their way of doing what Jez just said. That's how you get 100% of your money staying in-house. You know, once you start using Steam or you start using Epic, you are going to give some of those dividends away. Maybe they don't care, and that's why I think some of the delayed launches work outside of the games as a service.
Because they get their money back. Like, yeah, that's why they do movie theaters, Mooch. Remember, everybody's putting their stuff like a day and date. They're like, oh, the future of movies is day and date on everywhere. More people to watch the movies. And as soon as those theaters opened up, everybody said, theaters only. Get your money back.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, that's what they want. Now they're trying to get people back in theaters and justifying all that stuff and not. Well, yo, look at it. Not working. You want to. Yo, not. I was just going to say, like, we're not crazy Taylor Swift fans, but look at what she did with the waterfall method. She did a concert, then she put the concert in the movie theater.
That's right.
Then made it rent only for $25, and now I think they're going to sign $1 million a deal or something like with Disney for them to host it on their service. Man, she milked that show like at every level.
God. Oh, to
it's
the,
crazy. Yeah, that's the waterfall, dude.
It really is. No, you know, it's funny. So the one thing we didn't get a chance to talk about too tonight that I brought up over the course of the week was people have really been down on Marathon, which is a, you know, Bungie's game that's rumored to be coming out. People are saying, oh, it doesn't have longevity because it's an extract game. But here you have Helldivers 2 that's really put a spark into that gameplay mode, right? So that's a mode that maybe wouldn't have sat well before, but now it's caught everybody by storm. And it's funny, is Bungie helping Arrowhead or is Arrowhead actually going to give Bungie some tips here? But Marathon might end up being something, you know, kind of special if it is a good extraction game, right? I mean, there's a good shot of that now that this is now a mode we know people want to play.
Oh, it will be copied. It will be copied. Oh, and absolutely. I'm sure, yeah, this extraction type gameplay, like just how we've seen with Battle Royale, I think
isn't fair games the same thing?
It's like a bank extraction.
Yeah. I gotta be honest with you, anything that's like not space or not like some sort of sci-fi, I don't know if it has, because like Payday is not an extraction thing, or I don't know, I guess to
a it I guess it is. It is, right? Is an extraction.
Payday, I mean, you rob a bank.
It is. You rob a bank and you gotta get out of there.
I tell you, man, Payday put me into that Payday 3, and shout out to the, I don't remember who, I got a review code. Dude, I played the game. I put it on the CrossFire. I talked about it for a minute. That game put me into a coma. I mean, that was a really...
That game got a bad learning curve. Like, you really got to get, like, watch
it. Yeah, you got to get into that. I mean, I was like, it doesn't have to be as simple as Helldivers pick up and play. I'm all about a learning curve, but this was kind of like, it just didn't keep me enthralled. I couldn't, there's times, this is crazy to say. Like, I'm at work and I got people pinging me on my phone. They're like, dude, we're going to play, are we playing tonight? We dropping in? What time are we dropping in? I nobody was asking me on Payday, you know, what bank we hitting? Nobody said anything to me. So this is kind of a phenomenon. I'm enjoying it. I never tell anyone in the audience, you need to go buy. If I always say with the headset, if you're in the market, good for $150. If you're looking for a game right now that's outside of maybe a single player game and you want to be able to just jump into it and jump out, play 2-3 matches, and now that the servers seemingly in air quotes are working, that wasn't the case a couple days ago. Go over and check out. I mean, I think Helldivers 2 is a unique experience right now, and it's fun with the community. Not just your friends, but like just having random people come in and helpful, and everyone's engaging. I don't know. I've played with a lot of people I don't know, and it's been an absolute blast. That being said, guys, it is. I even kept them a little bit longer. But I do want to say thanks to everybody that was here tonight. Great panel. Great chat. Everybody, please do hit that like button. Hit the subscribe button on the way out. Like I said, we had a lot of new subscribers too. I appreciate that. Scott Woodford also just joined the channel. I appreciate it. It means a lot. Guys, go over to twitch.tv, Mooch TV, same as here, M00CH, drop the O's for zeros. Guys, go over and check it out. We are going to be doing Helldivers 2. I'm actually probably going to be doing a couple of other games and preparing to do an Elden Ring run. I've talked to a few people. I think maybe it'll be fun to kind of go through that. It wouldn't be something we do daily, but it'd be something between here, it is February, going through June till we get to the DLC. Might be a good time. Shout out to Mary Wilcox. I appreciate her being here as well. Going to go over there too. So please go. I've been seeing people. They are following. We did 2 streams last week. We're definitely going to do 2 this weekend as well. And then I'll get a census from the audience and what you guys want to see streamed after Helldivers. There's definitely going to be a couple of games to play, and I want to hear your input on it. That being said, guys, please hit that like button, hit the subscribe button. I want to say thank you so much to the guys that are here and still remaining here with us. The great B Money. B, I got a hold of you late, but it's great to have you on the show. I always told you, Thursday, 7 p.m., whenever you're available, shoot me a message. Be like, yo, I'm open tonight. Love to have it. Love your insight in gaming. B, let people know where they can find you. Thanks for being here tonight.
Yeah, appreciate the invite, man. I'm glad I can make it. Great show. If you want to find me, you can just find me everywhere at the same name, BMoney101. Once again, appreciate it, Mooch. I'll catch you next time, man.
Thank you, B. Appreciate you being here. The great Jack Move, Johnny. Johnny, I love every second of it. Jack, you're the best out there. I love how you really know how to get the entire community riled up. And that's, listen, that is a talent. And I don't care what anybody says. That is awesome, man. I love following you on there. You give a lot of insight into things. And that's the thing, you know. You'll put things out there on Twitter, and the initial read, I'm like, oh man, I don't know if I agree with Jack on that. And then you explain it, and I'm like, you know, listen, this is a man who's passionate about gaming. You've played more games than most people I've talked to, so I value your opinion, and I dig where you're coming from. So Jack, always great to have you on this show. You know, I'd like to have you on even more, but you know, listen. Let me know when you're free as well. I always say this. Don't be like, just Mooch. This is a crazy week. I got to get some shit off my chest. You come on this show anytime you want. But Jack, let people know where they can find you. Thanks for being here tonight.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Appreciate y'all, man. Good conversations tonight. Y'all can find me, man, everywhere, man. Jack Move, Johnny. I am very opinionated on social media. So if I say, I always like to tell people, man, if I say something that you like and you end up following, chances are I'm going to say some shit you don't like too, and you're going to want to unfollow. So just know that, okay? Just know that. I appreciate y'all.
Yo, great to have you here with us, Jack. Thank you. The great Jez from the Gaming Grindhouse. You guys know him as Jez7780. Jez, awesome to always chat with you, man. You know, new tech. You said this on your show yesterday. Go over and check out his show. He did an unboxing and a good initial review, a great initial review of the headset. And he says, you know, listen, I don't do just gaming. I do all things tech. So, Jez, let people know about the channel. Let them know where they can find you. And thanks for being here tonight.
Hey, man. Thanks for the invite, y'all. I love CrossFire is awesome, man. New on Thursdays, 7 p.m. Yo, hit that like button, everybody. But yeah, a great conversation, dude. I was listening. I was wanting to jump on earlier, but you know, kids. Know, goddamn. Anyway, those kids keep me up. But from having the conversation. But yo, great show. And yeah, you can catch me over at Jez7780, the Gaming Grindhouse. I do the podcast on Monday nights at 8 o'clock. But then I do, you know, shows throughout the week. Probably doing one tomorrow, just talking about, you know, the four games that came over, maybe some impressions on there. I always, you know, bring up the Phil Ness, you know, all the definitely Phil isms, as they say, but it's OG. It's called the Phil Ness. He's been duping everybody since 2000, circa 2016. But yeah, follow me over there. And then I just put up a little video about Mooch. I don't know if you saw it yet, but why Hellblade is taking so long. It was a clip from one of my shows.
Yeah, you did a minute.
Everybody wanted to see a short of it.
Video. So. It was awesome, man. Go over and check out
anyway,
go
check it out over there on the channel. But thanks, everybody. Hit that like button and share it out.
Appreciate it. A couple quick shout-outs to the guys who had to leave early. Brap, you guys know Brap_podcast on Twitter, and he does this show at 9 o'clock Wednesday nights. We're trying to get him to move it to 7 or 8, so it's a little earlier. The great Brap, everybody. Eric Jackson at ECJAXSON. Go over and follow Eric, the voice of reason. The great Mr. Badbit as well. Go over and follow him. It's at Mr. Badbit, and of course the Trophy Room. And the great Gaming Forte. Forte, it's hard for him to make Thursdays. He does a show right after this one. So shout out to him and Slow Mo who are doing DPS. Go over and give them some support and some love right after you guys leave here. Guys, outstanding show. And I want to say shout out real quick to Jack Move Johnny for following me over on Twitch. I appreciate that. I'm gonna get him a shout out right there. Appreciate that, man. Listen, we got a co-stream one time too, Jack. When there's a game you want to do that, you just give me a shout out. I appreciate it. You guys are all great. Hit the like button on the way out. We'll see you guys next Thursday, 7 p.m. Eastern. And again, Sunday and Saturday, Mooch TV, twitch.tv. We'll see you guys next week. Peace out and good night.